I'm going to show off a little bit because I can.
5, 4, 3, 2.
Hello. We've got some must-see TV for you today. Catch a Contractor with Adam Carolla premieres Sunday, February 28th at 10 p.m. or 9 central on Spike. Spike. Ooh. Tune in as Master Contractor and Carpenter Adam Carolla and his team track down shoddy contractors and bring them to justice. For the contractor, it's a chance of redemption. For the families, Adam brings home the justice they're looking for. For the viewers, it's brilliant entertainment. Tune in Sundays starting February 28th on Spike. Hey, kids. Squarespace also sponsoring today's episode of the chat show. Squarespace, the all-in-one platform that makes it fast and easy to create your own professional website or online portfolio. For a free trial and 10% off, go to squarespace.com and use offer code POLLACK. That's P-O-L-L-A-K. Welcome back, everybody, to Kevin Pollak's Chat Show. We've been away. How about you? Not buffering. And for those of you who enjoy the show audibly, that's got to suck.
It really does.
Also, you think that every week they go, oh, fuck, he did it again, and no one cares.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's what I know what Jamie's thinking.
Well, that's how we feel. Work
you say
with
that
you.
About everything you do. Nobody cares.
Literally 5 years now, and every time you do it, I'm like, is this the stroke?
You know it's coming.
Because one of these days, yeah. you're gonna be the boy who cried wolf.
And by the way,
at least I've learned to not talk over them.
That
I used
will
to
be
do that all the time. I used to be like, oh wait, we're doing the thing.
I want to be the Dick Shauna podcast.
Yeah. You're gonna stroke out, and it's gonna take us 20 minutes to get you help.
Or let everyone know.
Just to figure out, yeah. Oh no, this is not the longest buffering.
I'm asking the universe right now to let me be the Dick Shauna of podcasting. I do want to die live on the podcast.
All right.
Yeah, okay.
Done.
Thank you, universe. First of all, the big thanks out to our dear friend and poker pal who's made the game last couple of weeks, Shelley Azoff, who set Jamie and I up with all the premium passes last night to see Paul Simon and Sting. And we're going to talk about that odd coupling in a moment. Last night at the new Fabulous Forum, which they've totally refurbished, and it's pretty fucking exciting.
Simon and Sumner?
Simon and Sumner.
Yeah. Gordy.
Gordy. Yeah. Dana Carvey's old bit, which I
kept
still
doing
love.
That last. I kept doing yeah. Dana's old bit of, you named yourself a verb.
Hey, fellas, tense. Would you guys mind calling me Sting? Shut up, Gordy.
he would do this thing. Dana would do this thing.
Yeah. Why? yeah, it really was a bizarre coupling. When they sang together, it sounded sweet. Which Paul Simon even commented on, which was kind of funny. And it was so ironic because I can't say MILFs because I didn't want to fuck any of them, but the 40-something women in front of us who would get up and dance beautifully while Sting performed would sit, they couldn't sit down fast enough when Paul Simon was on. And then Jamie and I were up and I was dancing horribly just to get in their face, but they never turned around. But it was, you know, what a strange, you know, promoters obviously put this thing together. Yeah, sure, Sting, you could sell out the Forum, but if you had Paul Simon, you could definitely sell it out. And then vice versa, do they need each other? What is the point? I don't understand.
I feel like it's like a bar bet the two of them had.
We were talking about this before the show, and it's like these two performers together does not make any sense to us.
Yeah, and you really start to realize as you're watching these two, Sting is all about the music and the vibe, and you get up and you can't, you have to move, and Paul Simon is that and great lyrics on top. And just, I don't know. It was a very.
I was saying, where's my James Taylor Paul Simon concert?
Right?
Mixed together. That's
they hand out pillows at the entrance.
They hand out.
What?
I enjoy both those artists very much.
So do I. But I'm just saying they both have tender songs.
Ah. And then I also wanted to give a shout out to the fine folks at the San Francisco Sketch Fest, which we went up to last weekend.
Jamie and
our own Dr. Chen went up the weekend before. And as much as I'd like to share details with you about that weekend, nobody's talking. We got to mic Dr. Chen at some point because we do need to hear about his version of what Sketchfest was like. But they went
Sammy was with us that weekend too.
Slipknots.
I had a bunch of shows.
Sammy.
Nobody cares.
I'm going to get to Sammy in a second to tell me about her shows. But Slipknots.
Yes.
The sketch group that everyone's been waiting to see live on stage, introduced on the Conan O'Brien program, or program.
When do you think that was, Kenny? Like 10 years ago, probably? Yeah.
Yeah, it's got to be quite a while ago because John Glazer was still a writer on the show.
Definitely pre-9/11 because a lot of conspiracy theorists believe that Slipknots had something to do with the Ultimate Decision.
Oh, you're thinking of the band Slipknot.
Slipknot. Slipknots. So tell me about the reunion. First of all, they came out and did their bit.
Which is like a 90-second bit. No, it's like a 90-second bit.
And there's pounds of nuts on the floor.
Yes, many nuts, bags of nuts.
They come out, they slip. They try to get back up, they slip.
Yeah.
90 seconds later, they go, all right, good night.
Yes, and then they went off stage, brought the house lights up for a couple minutes, and then they came back out and was like, oh, apparently we're contracted to fill 90 minutes here. So they were trying to think of more creative ways to do it, so that they did it in like super slow-mo.
Then
they came out again with like craft service. They were like, we're tripping on broccoli. Like, and then they just had like other comics come out. And there was some videos too that they made.
And Sammy, tell us about your shows at the Sketchfest.
I did three, the first of which you can hear. I did the Chewin' It podcast with Kevin Heffernan and Steve Lemmy. It's available for download now. Do not download it while you are listening to this show, however. Please wait until the conclusion. Do not turn to another channel.
See, I'm fine downloading it. Just don't listen.
Don't listen to it. Don't have Paul Ekachatro in one ear and Chewing It in the other. No. That will not work.
And drive your car?
I've tried.
What year is this?
Honestly. And then what else did I do? I did a competitive erotic fan fiction, which is also a podcast.
That should be.
I didn't know that was a podcast.
And I don't know if that one's posted yet, but check my Twitter feed. I will let you know the second that it does. And then I did Stardom, the Bill Dwyer-hosted Game show,
yeah.
Which was tremendous fun.
Tell us again your Twitter handle.
I'm at Sam Levine, SammLevine.
Lovely. We should promote our own Twitter handles more often. By that, I mean your own.
Well.
Where do we find Dr. Chen? Is it evil? Is it at Evil Dr. Chen now?
No, I should make it.
No?
No.
Just at Kenny Chen?
I haven't updated my Twitter in 5 years.
These kids are moving off to the Instagram. Jamie's been off the Twitter as well.
I don't care for it.
All right.
Who needs to see your photos of lunch?
We're coming to you live on YouTube, those of you watching us on the live stream. The rest of you catching us after the fact, after your February 16th, tune in live once, won't you? Michael Showalter, I believe, next Sunday, and Anna Faris the Sunday after that, Academy Awards Sunday. I think we might do an early show so everyone can get to their Academy Award brunches.
A lot of brunching happening on Sundays.
Subscribe to us on YouTube. Write a review, you fucks. I think that's it. I believe that is the pre-show nonsense. Did you watch the Tom Hanks and Larry David show? It's up on the iTunes and the Earwolf and the YouTube. And now for today's guest, which we're unbelievably excited about. We've had a couple of dozen. I don't know the exact number. Possibly 26. Former cast members of Saturday Night Live. This is our first active. But I'm going to start the show this way. Kobe. Shaylin. Taryn. Smulders. Kill him. Can I please buy a real name? Please welcome Taryn Kill.
My given name, man.
Why do I have to attack it?
Who I am.
All right, let's go somewhere else then. Los Angeles.
We have weird names, all right? Kobe is Yakoba, too.
Sure
so
it
she
is.
She brought it closer to America.
To reality.
Yeah, exactly.
And Shaylin, I didn't want to mispronounce. Is it Cato?
Cadeau.
Cadeau.
Yes.
I knew I would mispronounce it.
Yeah, yeah.
Because you can't, you don't want to do Cato because of the...
Because of the Green Hornets sidekick?
I was thinking OJ's pool boy.
Oh, aren't we all?
Yeah. It's always nice occasionally to run into Cato Kalin. Have you had that experience?
I've never had, no.
Because he still has that attitude like, hey, what's up? How's it going? Like,
yeah, sure.
Like, you're not a circus freak for your entire existence?
Sure.
Yeah.
Just pushing down this horrible experience?
And same hair.
Yeah. Same good hair. For him.
Yeah, you want to hold on to that.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, he's at my guest house right now, and he's been great.
Right.
He's quiet. He pays the rent on time.
And when you run by in the middle of the night, mm-hmm. with a bloody glove.
He wasn't looking.
He looked the other way.
He's vacuuming with headphones on.
If he's learned nothing else, it's to vacuum every night with headphones on. Just in case.
Yeah.
Has anybody ever done the whole show facing this way, by the way?
No, that would be...
Because
be a first.
You're getting notes from your control room.
We have
here.
Had people look at themselves.
There's a monitor here, mm-hmm. and then you have a teleprompter, if need be, right there. Like this, and I have a curtain to look at.
That's a lovely filing cabinet.
No, that's true. That's true.
Come on.
Yeah, numbers 37 through 40. That's where they keep the good stuff.
God forbid. let's go here, then. Los Angeles High School for the Arts.
Yeah.
Telling a stranger that at age 15, ever get your ass handed to you?
Loxa. No, I guess it should have. No, there's prestige.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Well, I grew up in Big Bear, right? Which is like mountain town. Football's a big deal.
Yeah, you came from crushing bears' skulls.
Yeah.
That's why one of the things
I was
going to ask. Then son, put the bear's head down.
Right.
We'd like to send you to the Los Angeles High School.
Yes, Papa.
That'll get you to the School of Arts.
Yeah. No, it was a culture clash for sure, but even in Big Bear,
you were ready.
I was you know, school play guy. Right. You know, I don't think it surprised anybody. But I was athletic too. Like in Big Bear, I played baseball and soccer and was pretty good at both. But there are no sports teams at LOXA.
No.
You look shocked.
Well, can you still tell us how to drain a deer?
Oh, man.
Just from
what
memory.
Do I do? What do I do? No. I did horseback riding.
Sure.
There was, like, definitely the Big Bear Rodeo, and you could go to that. Oktoberfest. I don't know. I was not as mountainy as I should be. These are, like, what I felt like. This only happens here. Little did I know, there's a country called Germany. I was a nice, well-rounded kid, I think.
Yeah, I mean, I've got a quote here, if I may. You described yourself, weird dichotomy of nerd sports fan and musical theater.
I never said that. that's exactly right.
Maybe
not necessarily in that order, but pretty close to that order. Nerd first, for sure.
Right.
And then my dad was a pretty good athlete and almost went to college to kind of pursue that road of playing in the majors and stuff. And
would have been great if you ended a period on the word college.
Almost went to college. You know, little victories for us,
yeah.
us small town folk from
Big Bear. We didn't ask for a lot. My dad almost went to college. So he must have went on a scholarship, you were saying.
Yeah. He was good enough, and scouts were involved at one point, I think, maybe. But he was bit by the acting bug pretty severely and pursued that. So it was a good balance, I think. I like me.
How did they settle in... here's one. How did they settle in Big Bear to begin with? Because you were born...
Not financially well off.
Sure.
We were in Redondo Beach. We were in the South Bay. And they could afford to buy there. My father at that point was in construction, had his own construction firm crew. So he knew they could buy something small, build on it, hopefully flip it down the line. They also had five kids whom they all wanted to go.
Is that an Irish thing?
Good school. No, it's a slutty mom thing.
I gotcha.
different dads for my two older sisters.
We've said too much.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, I shot up there momentarily for the classic known as Dr. Dolittle 2.
Of course.
So,
Can we stand?
They can't hold me in frame. I would stand, but there's no one manning the camera.
Luckily, it's audio, so if you just tell them you're standing. And I just remember thinking, it's so hard to believe this is that close to Los Angeles, and you could be anywhere in the world. I mean, other than the accents, it is as stunningly beautiful of a mountainside town as it gets.
I agree. I truly love it. I was there from age like 6.5 to 16.
Yeah.
And I just loved it. So clean, snow in the winter, lake sports in the summer. You know, it's the place, you know, you open your door and your dogs run out in the neighborhood, and when it's dinner time, they come running back, sort of thing. It was really pretty ideal for a kid of that age, you know. And that's what Big Bear, I think it's like around probably 37,000 population, and it's a lot of like middle class families that go up for, because it's a pretty good school system too. And then there's a big departure of families. People leave the mountain to create opportunity for said kids.
And then there's that feeling of, Little House on the Prairie, or what was the Good Night, John Boy?
Oh,
The Waltons.
The Waltons. A little bit of The Waltons as well, where you do come down from the mountain at some point.
Yeah.
To the big damn city.
Yeah. Oh, for sure. We went back down to the South Bay, which is where we'd come from, so we had connections and family and friends there. So it didn't seem super foreign. There was still some. And my dad, he would commute. We were there for 9 years. I would say he had 3 or 4 jobs in Big Bear in that time span.
The rest of the time?
The rest of the time, he'd get up at like 3 a.m. on Monday, drive down to the South Bay, where a lot of his business was, drive back up Friday afternoon. And then he would also coach sports. He'd coach Little League or soccer, so he'd come up for a Wednesday afternoon, head right back down Thursday morning. Pretty amazing.
And if I go to the dry cleaners in the bank in the same day,
I know.
I've got to lie down.
You need a 4-hour nap, it was, and so him doing that and me getting into the arts high, the first year, my sophomore year of high school, I commuted with him. I'd go down during the week, stay at my grandmother's in Long Beach, go to school, and then come back on the weekends. And my mom was like, enough, we'll go back down. So we ended up in Manhattan Beach. But that first, I remember the first day in Loxa, signing up for classes, going into the administration office. I'm there with my dad, and we're like trying to get me into computer science or whatever, you know, some transfer. And next to us is a very lovely gentleman who I came to know as Anthony. Pirate stockings, a tight black skirt, like a sort of Michael Jackson-y blazer, like military style jacket, you know, with a little bit of fringe. White, face painted white.
No.
Redrawn eyebrows.
This is for signing up for classes?
He's just there doing his business. Yeah, I mean, we had guys who would show up to school in dresses. There, you know, it was an incredible school.
It was Anthony
school.
Hopkins, right?
It was.
Did okay.
That wasn't clear. Good point.
Sorry, he was researching a role.
That wasn't clear.
No, oh my God, we were all white bread kids. at the time, you're 15, and I really think, like, the decision to go to that school was, Darren, you got into this high school. Big Bear High School is a year-round schedule, which means like there's no summer break. There's a month in summer, a month in winter. So if you want to go back to Big Bear High, you have to go to school next week. And if you want to choose to go to Loxa, you have another month of summer. And I was like, Loxa! Loxa! And that is the decision that changed the course of my life. Because I wanted more time off of school. It's so true. Like that, like time off and girls, every major decision in my life has been motivated by those two factors.
So lazy and horny.
Yeah. Oh my God.
Are the two words used most when describing my dear friend Taryn? Is Eddie? I'm going to screw up this name too. Okay. Redmayne, your mortal enemy, as you once insisted.
You know, I'm hot and cold on that guy. If we're going to be honest, I'm hot and cold. He'll give an out. I saw him in Red. On Broadway.
On the Broadway.
Fudge, he was good. Mm-hmm. So good. And then he's also that sort of like quivering, trembling, like I watched Pillars of the Earth and kind of wanted to pull my hair out. Didn't know nothing about the guy.
No.
Could be literally the most generous, greatest human being on the planet.
Well.
But as a fan.
It's interesting you say that.
You have.
We got him to say this about you.
Oh my gosh.
Totally kidding.
Oh.
Ah. This is where the show would be great.
Oh, man.
When we have the production meetings and I say, these are the areas we need to improve on. When I say we go to the thing, we gotta have a thing!
Yeah.
That's my bad. I forgot to call it.
Jeremy!
That's all right. It's a strictly snobby, yeah. You know, cine-snob.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's fucking awesome is what it is. Then let's jump to the present. We go from the early Big Bear days right up to the illegitimates. I'm unbelievably excited about this. Nice. Please tell us more. How did this whole thing start? Guys in the outer shell, I forgot to ask, pull up a graphic if you can from the interwebs. From The Illegitimates, the new comic book that was launched December?
Yeah, exactly right. Yeah. Yeah. I love comic books. I love all things superhero-y comic animation therein. Mm-hmm. And this was an idea I've had for quite a while. And I think like the first iteration was I lived in an apartment with like five dudes and trying to think of funny concepts for the five of us to come together and play brothers, but we don't look alike, and what would that mean?
Right.
And also being a huge, huge James Bond fan, came up with this concept that, you know, what if on many of his, you know, conquests, there was some baggage to come out of it, some real life ramifications of having sex unprotected, kids. You gotta protect yourself. Mm-hmm. So that's where it came out of, like, you know, bastard children of James Bond from his various adventures. And that idea, I was like, that's really fun. I really, really like that idea, as opposed to wasting this on whatever web video I'd have shot with my roommates. Sorry, roommates.
Yeah.
Sorry, guys, I love you, but you were dead weight.
Also known as quicksand.
Quicksand. I just started to explore it a little more earnestly, and had a friend, Mark Andreyko, who helped write The Illegitimates with me, who has worked in comic books, and said, is this a thing? He said, it's definitely a thing. I'd love to help you work on it. Great. How? I don't have time. And neither of us did. And right. Then I got a really cool job, and it gave me a little bit more money to have in my
That's a sentence.
In my account.
Mm-hmm.
I just finally said, I'll pull the trigger, and I had this great sort of New York moment on the subway my first season with said deadweight roommates. They come out annually, we do a guy trip. And there was this beautiful family, husband, wife, and a daughter close to my daughter's age, and he kind of did the look, and he's like, hey, aren't you on? I said, yeah, and he said, and you're married too? And I said, yeah, I am. He said, she came to our offices. And I said, where do you work? He's like, oh, I'm the editor for Batman Comics at DC. And I went, had to push my giant erection down. Mike March is the nicest guy. And I was like, I was there on that tour. That was my Father's Day gift from Kobe, was to tour the DC offices in New York, which is the best. And so I invited him to a show, and we struck up a friendship. And then I sort of just said, okay, I want to try to make this a reality, and 2.5 years later, The Illegitimates is on shelves, which is really awesome.
How often do issues?
Monthly.
So we're now three in?
Three came out at the beginning of February.
And how unbelievably, first of all, walk me through the various stages of that to, let's jump to hot off the press. You're sure. Holding issue one.
Yeah. There's a lot. So it's reaching out to Mike.
I mean, there's a shit ton work we can't even fathom.
I bit off
two
so
and
much
a half
more
years.
than I could chew.
Yeah.
And fortunately had very smart, creative mouths around me to help digest it.
But also wildly busy with SNL.
Yeah.
So that you could have this creative, extraordinary moment in your own life.
Yeah.
While giving birth to this side project that would otherwise consume your life.
Yes. No, and should be. And I guess if there's any regret, and there are not much because it's a reality, and it's maybe the thing that I'm most proud of just because it came only of me initially. But it's a full-time thing, and it should be a full-time thing, and I just myself haven't allowed for it to be my one and only thing. It's been one of probably three or four things. But fortunately, Mark helping me write, Kevin, our artist. So that was the first step, is reaching out to Mike, get me in touch with artists, inkers, colorists, that whole process of putting it together.
Right.
Sent me names. I just reached out via email, and people were on board and excited. And issue one was done fairly quickly. Issue one was kind of completed, And we used that as a selling tool to go around to different publishers. Because we could have done it online and we could have self-published, but that would have been a lot more money out of my pocket.
Is that the first?
Yeah, yeah. So this is Jerry Ordway, who did artwork for like the Death of Superman series. He's just an incredible, incredible artist. And yeah, this is the subscription cover that you can't see on your
looks like a couple of Lugers iPhone. For the L's and the illegitimates, and then pregnant yep. silhouettes.
Yeah, 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 yeah. Bond sipping a martini with a bunch of pregnant Bond girls around. yeah, and then IDW, who's been phenomenal and publishes a ton of titles that I love. Like, I'm a huge Ninja Turtles guy. I really love Lock and Key. And then they do Ghostbusters and Transformers, so a lot of properties that right. I enjoy. And they were the ones who like got it and said yes and came on board and yeah now it's in stores.
Yeah. And you did a shit ton of press for it initially.
As much as people would let me do.
Yeah, I mean, when our own J-Mac puts together the dossier, there were 35 pages. That's all he could come up with.
Okay.
Being the wuss that he is. But
wow.
31 of those 35 pages were about the press that you did. No, I'm kidding. Awesome. It was pretty great how much stuff there was and how much.
Yeah, it's important to me. And like I said, it's
but also
just
maybe
a project of love.
The timing of the 2.5 year wait allowed you to not only settle in and find your way and be comfortable and be a breakout in your new job.
Sure.
But also get to this lofty place of by last December. You almost couldn't have been in a better opportunity to get access to all the promotion the comic book would need.
Absolutely.
So that's kind of great.
It was great. It worked out as good as can be, and I earnestly feel no spin that each issue of the comic, we've done 6 now, each issue gets so much better just because I'm a greenhorn, so what do I know? But have surrounded myself with really talented people that have been very, very helpful.
We mentioned the Dana Carvey reference. I can remember being on the phone with him. I'm sorry for those of you I told this story before on the show. And he said, I said, what's going on this week? He said, I got to do Ross Perot. I said, what does that mean? He said, I don't know. They gave me a tape of him on Larry King, and I got to do it by Saturday. No one had ever thought about doing it. He'd only been on Larry King twice. It wasn't in really the... You know, he was in the zeitgeist, but the idea of mocking him yet, people were still wowed by him in those early days. And so he and I shot the shit on the phone. By the end of the call, we both had a flawless Ross Perot.
Wow.
And I said, well, this stinks because Saturday you're going to become famous for doing Ross Perot.
Yeah, yeah.
And then I'm just the asshole that's doing Dana Carvey's Ross Perot.
Sure, sure.
How is it for you, because you had to audition, which we'll get to, and you came fully loaded with your own stuff and impressions and things, and then that just that task of learning someone new. They're going to throw a tape of you. Here's a guy you've never even thought about doing.
Yeah.
Like, was the Michael Cera already in your quiver, or did you have to learn that?
Michael Cera, I have my own Kevin Pollak, was a suggestion from my friend Todd Stashwick when I was auditioning. Ooh. And he's like, I think you could do a really good Michael Cera. So he planted that seed, and just going back and watching it. And it's literally first season Arrested Development Michael Cera. I'm sure you'll appreciate this, and it's not to cheapen it, but I have taken doing impressions for granted because it's a little musical. I hear it.
Yeah.
It's not like I'm... You know, all right, another rep. You know, I got to get into this.
Yeah.
It's sort of like I see and I kind of go... and then people go, hey, that sounds like a thing.
That did not sound like a thing.
No, it doesn't. I've got to come up with original characters too, Kevin. Do not stifle my process.
Then I'd like to call that one Philip, if I may.
It's actually a perfect impression of Todd Stashwick, who I also know.
Yeah. He's the does good impressions too himself. Yeah, he's a very funny guy, Second City guy.
How much did Mickey Mouse factor in when building the Michael Cera? Because there's a little bit.
Oh, not intentionally.
No?
No.
All right. Because I got to Bill Clinton by starting with Jimmy Carter and adding Elvis Presley.
Oh, okay.
There's always, I find sometimes, there's a soup.
Yeah, it always comes after the fact. People go like, oh, that sounds like your thing. And I go like, oh, yeah, I guess it does that. But I try to go straight for the target. But impressions to me, like comedy in general, I was like an actor kid, like show busy-ish family. My mom took me and my younger siblings out to audition like when I was 5 and they were 3 and 1 or whatever. And I was the only one who could walk into a room and be like, hi, you know.
I like your shirt.
You know.
Right.
But it wasn't necessarily like full. I didn't have full blown kid actor syndrome. It was like 5 to 7, and then 3 years off, and then got back into it a little bit when I was around 12, and then another break, and then once I got to the high school, I got very serious about it.
That's when you would run into Sam Levine at auditions.
Exactly. Yeah.
And
yeah,
say,
yeah.
We can't be up for the same part, can we?
Nope. The aforementioned Stunky and Blitz, was it the yes. first thing we read for together?
Yeah, I feel like that's the first time we met.
Okay, yeah.
How old were you guys?
Fox family. 18.
Yeah, 18, 19.
82?
Same year, yeah.
82?
Yeah.
Yeah.
We're all within 6 weeks of each other, actually.
Yeah, we are actually. Are January, he's March.
You're April.
Oh, awesome.
The Fool's Day.
Indeed.
Yeah. Yeah, actual April Fool's. I know. So I should have seen it coming, but it was always like... I'm gonna act, like, you know, like I was doing pilot seasons and
right.
like I tested for Smallville for the best friend role, you know.
Right.
And then comedy happened accidentally, which my older sister Rachel Warner, who actually had few run-ins with you in San Jose, the San Jose Improv, which is where she lives now.
That's hilarious.
Is 8 years older than me and hipper and funnier than I could ever have hoped to have been in our youth. So like. SNL, Kids in the Hall, and anything cool, you know, she found it first, and I kind of like fed off of her droppings.
Was she turning you on to it?
Yeah.
In a sense?
Absolutely.
Which is
absolutely,
great.
Yeah.
The way that Jamie's sister drug her to see, what was it, Indian Summer, I think.
Yeah, well, my sister Jacqueline molded my entire taste in pop culture, so.
Yeah.
When it came to music, whatever.
But I'll tell you, I'm envious. I have one older brother who turned me on to nothing.
Yeah.
Other than pot, which I thank him for to this day. But but there was no, well, Jill, hey, you've got to see Blazing Saddles.
Jill, my eldest sister, not at all. Like, the only thing she's really into is James, she loves the James Bond movies. Other than that, she's not into like pop culture at all. But Jacqueline is like, yeah, she was, yeah.
But I find it's one or the other where you have, it's either a sibling or a friend. Somebody says, you've got to...
Yeah.
Fill in the blank.
So. Yeah, she was, my comedy education mostly came through her. My dad was like Monty Python, Bill Cosby, Mel Brooks,
right.
all that stuff. But
me, probably.
All you. Mostly you. Now that I think about it, entirely you.
Weird.
I think the other people I said were you doing them.
All right.
So the concept of being a comedian or being on SNL...
I had
a better time like fathoming being a movie star
sure.
than being Luke Skywalker than being on SNL.
Right.
And then I'm 19. The management firm that I'm with represents Kenan Thompson, and Mad TV calls and says, "Does Kenan want to audition?" And they said, "No, not right this second. But we have a guy who we feel you should see." Because impressions were a thing I just came to me and would do to make people laugh, and I was loud and obnoxious and funny-ish.
At 19, who were your impressions?
There was a lot of young guys. It was like the Hall of Fame of WB, right? So it was like Josh Jackson and James Vanderbeek. It was like all that stuff.
You gotta give us a little Vanderbeek.
All right, I think we're. Oh, come on, Joey. You can't possibly think I'm not going to get into NYU. Sort of that thing.
Sure.
So it was like that, and they had me go in, and then I'd take like big, I'd do like a Bono, which was me just doing the Beautiful Day dance over furniture, and it was just a freak thing where I was like, what a sketch show? I couldn't. Can I? This will be fun.
And 19 to be a main cast member hadn't happened.
Yeah. I mean, I did half a season. I was featured, you know, low man. But yeah, I was 19 and got the gig and Mad TV for half a year. And that just thrust. I remember the TV Guide article that said comedians Bobby Lee and Taron Killam, and I was like, I'm an actor. How dare you, sir?
So that's where Jebediah was born
yeah,
from.
Yeah, exactly.
That exact moment in time.
Oh, great.
19-year-old.
Right up in TV Guide.
Is that before or after this week's loser on The Biggest Loser?
The outrage of a 19-year-old. There's nothing funnier.
Yeah. But no, and after that, it was comedy became the focus.
Yeah, well, Groundlings. So was Dick Blasucci still at the Mad TV?
Dick was running it.
Okay, because I met through the Christopher Guest and.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, and always loved Dick.
Very nice guy. Very nice guy. That year was crazy because I'm on a sketch show, and I remember like the debut of Mad TV after the Super Bowl. Stay tuned after the Super Bowl for the Mad TV special and. You know, Phil Lamar and Brian Callen and, you know, and Nicole Sullivan seeing all these people. You know. It was crazy. And I was so unprepared. I just was plunged into the deep end, not knowing what to do. And like, hey, is this a sketch? And like, I even like have some notes written down from
just the lamest
sketch idea. Just awful. Just, you know, college freshman sketches that
you were
do.
19 like, for
yeah,
fuck's sake.
Yeah. But a balance of like a strong performer doesn't know how to write for himself. And there were people who really looked out for me. And on the cast, it was like Will Sasso and Mo were great, were so great and took me under their wing and looked out for me. And then on the writing side in particular, Michael Hitchcock his door was always open. He was so helpful. Anything of any substance that I got on the air, I feel was written by him, at least in part. And then so many of the other people that I respected and were the people I looked to, you know, like Jennifer Joyce was there, and Michael McDonald, all these people had come from the Groundlings Theater. Mm. So when I left MAD, because they did ask me back, but for fewer episodes than promised.
Fuck them.
And that's what I was told to say. And my mom was like, what? You left college for this job and now you're turning it down? But all the representatives at the time said, you're better off if you leave, and so glad now that they said that. But I enrolled in a Groundlings class because I said, I just don't know how to do it.
That was the remarkable thing in going through the research was the amount of time you put in at Groundlings after Mad TV.
Yeah.
And not knowing anything that you just shared with us, my assumption would have been, why would you be on Mad TV if you hadn't been driving towards that? But it's kind of great to hear the... Never on my radar until an agent said, here's what you need to do.
Yeah.
Let's pause for a moment to give a little more thanks to Mike Hitchcock, who we just saw at the Sketch Fest. I did one improv show. It's kind of like ASCAT, where I was the monologist and he was with the group that was along
with
you
do theme Mike, park?
Yeah.
Theme park, yeah. Michael Higgins.
Rachel Dratch.
Rachel Dratch, who we love. And the, is it Cole Stratton?
Yes.
Cole Stratton.
And Jana Varney.
And Jana Varney, two of the founders of Sketch Fest.
And there was one other female who I don't remember.
How kind of you. But yeah, Hitchcock destroys.
I think Hot Tits, right? She goes by Hot Tits?
Hot Tits McGee.
Hot Tits McGee. And Michael Hitchcock is as enthusiastic and mad and carefree on stage as he was the first time he stepped on the boards at Groundlings.
There's a great Michael Hitchcock story that happened in recent history, probably the last 2 years. He was in an improv at the Groundlings Theater. And they have a game, I think it's one-man show, where it's like, you're about to see a one-man show. Give us a topic of what his one-man show is about, and he's going to make it all up. And I think it was natural disasters or something like that. And he's just so funny, and especially in that environment where he's just all the energy. But he's building, he plays an earthquake, and he plays an avalanche. And then he goes, look at me, I'm a tornado! And he spins and falls off the stage, not intentionally.
Into the audience?
Into the audience. Falls and collapses into the lap and just keeps going.
Sure. Because he's Liza Minnelli at that point.
Yeah. It was maybe top three funniest things ever seen in my life.
Oh, that's pretty great.
Yeah.
All right, well, let's...
End it.
I can't take any more. No, I was going to say, in terms of the Groundlings, you know, we've had some people from there pass through and talk about Lisa Kudrow and Lovitz come to mind.
Was Sherry O'Terry one?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, and he was on here too.
Farrell?
Well, some girls.
Mm-hmm. Where was Lorraine from?
Yep, Groundlings.
Lorraine?
She was the only LA person.
Because I remember not to name drop, but I was just talking to her last week, and yes, I remember she was.
Up in San Francisco during Sketchfest.
Yeah. She was saying that she's from here.
Yeah.
She was doing it here.
Yeah.
Let's jump around, which I like to do.
Please.
What's the real reason you didn't warn the world, or at least the United States, about Amanda Bynes?
I truly, you know, I was on the Amanda show, first job out of high school, Amanda show.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know Dan Schneider?
Yeah, I'm going to say yes.
Okay. He was on Head of the Class. He's created every Nickelodeon show from all that on, basically.
Yeah.
He's the emperor of Nickelodeon. And he gave me my first gig out of high school, and I'm 18, Amanda's 14, just this charming, sweet, lovely girl.
Oh, no, Sammy's worked with her as well. Mm-hmm. He's done a motion picture with her.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I did it. I got to there. I had to earn that. I was unproven. I did not have the illustrious body of work. Critical Darling, Freaks and Geeks under my belt. So I ended up doing 7 of those, and we became friends, and then did Big Fat Liar. I played a bully in that, and we touched base, and then she and I were close for a number of years, and then fell out of touch. So I think our last conversation was when I was 21 or something. So right. I was saying to Sam before that at this point, no matter where she would have landed, it'd just be like meeting somebody for the first time, I think, because who you are at, 17 and 21 and who you are at 31 and
for 27 is for everyone involved.
Completely, completely different.
Yeah.
In the time I knew her, nobody more charming, smarter.
Yeah. Well, lovely, isn't that the beautiful. Heartbreak? Isn't
it's,
that
it's
the
awful.
Heartbreak?
It's awful.
Of how wonderful she was?
Yeah.
Because there are a lot of people who end up being crazy who always were.
Sure.
Or not, having issues.
It's a topic that, I just don't know much about, and I also feel like, how much do you know of the specifics of the situation? But just from the photos and the stories and the headlines you do see, you just want, at one point in my life, she was one of my favorite people.
Sure.
So I hope it's all better now.
She's going to be okay.
I hope so, yeah.
Yeah. Because it seems to be a shock for just about everyone that was close to her or did work with her. You know, when Rip Torn holds up a bank in his pajamas at 5 in the morning, no one says, what?
Yeah. You saw there, the writing was on the wall. Yeah.
Now, is it possible that your 7,498 hours playing the Nintendo 64 game GoldenEye had contributed to the
illegitimacy?
100%. Yeah.
100%.
These are just going to be random questions.
Wait, that was the amount of hours you logged?
7,498.
At least.
Dude, you were so close to 10,000, you could have been an outlier.
I'm not done. I have a working Nintendo 64 in my New York apartment. And
Which one is yours, Jamie? The retro one or the original?
The original NES.
The original NES.
Oh, yeah. Oh, that's great. Yeah, my buddy Hunter. The guy group that comes, we do Mario Kart 64 and GoldenEye. And Hunter Houston knows where you'll respawn in GoldenEye. If you play multiplayer, he knows on every level when you're killed the next place you'll respawn. So if he gets the golden gun and he kills you, it's the most infuriating thing. Because your screen then becomes zoop, zoop, just 10 times in a row. It's awful. It's impressive, but it's awful.
How much fun for him, though?
Oh, my God. He's a god. He is a god. I know you will be back, and I know where it will be.
He can't beat that.
Yeah.
Also, in college, when you weren't playing the GoldenEye,
mm-hmm.
the sloppy swish may have begun.
Yeah.
Is that possible?
Yeah, that's my go-to dance circle move.
You know
what I mean? Like, oh,
sure.
But
you probably didn't think it would become...
No.
How could you have? In fact, did it even dawn on you in the early phases of SNL? I mean, how soon into it did that come up?
You know, third season?
Right.
Third season.
You buried the lead.
I know. I should have broke with that. Well, yeah, I had good luck with this stupid, behind-the-scenes video. Like, Robin was the musical guest, and I was like, who's Robin? And they played the music video for me, and I was immediately in love. And I was like, this is the most catchy thing.
I had some of the crew before we went on.
Watch the Call Your Girlfriend.
Watch couple minutes of the original video, and then you in the
pink sweater
in the office. With Bobby Moynihan with the flashlight, and Vanessa Bayer, and
that was a very produced version of a bit I'd been doing that week, going into people's offices and like starting the song on their computer and dancing while they're trying to write, and driving people crazy.
Well, that was my question, because at one point towards the end of that video, you do see a guy at the computer in the middle of your office.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, who is that guy, and how do you reach that level of concentration?
Yeah.
That he's unaffected by
Harvard, man. That's Harvard, man. That's Harvard education. Yeah, no, that was great. It was Sarah Schneider, one of the writers, was like, you should just do that. You should film that video in your office. And at the time, I had like a, like maybe 80 square feet of office, maybe.
Sure.
And so I was like, that's great. And so at 4:30, I just went, will you do me a favor and come hold a flashlight? You know, will you do me a favor and come film this? And then we shot that. I was like, oh, this is maybe a thing. Like, if I were a fan, this is something I would love to see.
Oh, yeah.
So uploaded it and that caught on, and that was kind of a little realization of what Andy and Yorma and Akiva did for that show.
Sure.
Like, yes, there were pre-taped pieces on the show, but in terms of bringing like comedy pre-taped pieces into the new age of social media and technology, I mean, they changed the structure of the show. They really did, and bringing YouTube into that and watching videos the next day online.
And
they did that.
Music being a huge component.
Exactly right. Music videos, not really a thing up until that point. You know, a few, but not really.
Yeah.
And now it's almost a staple, like out of necessity, you know, just to keep the young viewers' eyes engaged.
Yeah. You could only hope to reach Dick in the Box.
I don't think you can. I think that is,
if I may,
the brass ring.
I don't think you should.
You're not a Dick in the Box guy. Come on. That's a sweet spot for me.
I get it.
That's a sweet spot for me.
I get it, and I tip my hat.
Okay.
Before the next round of questions, they're giving me a note that I should do the mid-roll. Would you mind if I bang these out?
Sure.
All right, cool. Yeah. Would you mind doing
it with me?
Wait.
Oh, you didn't want me to do it with you.
I do.
Oh, okay.
I would prefer you to do it with me. Yeah, I would prefer us to do it together to this camera. Ready?
Yeah.
We've got Spike's Catch-A-Contractor sponsoring today's episode of the Kevin Pollak Chat Show. Have you ever been cut by a gun?
You aren't going to go as high on that. I'm sorry. Do you want to take it back?
Let's try it again.
Okay.
Have you ever been cut by a bad tractor?
And I really follow teleprompters.
If so!
And we've got the show for you.
If not...
We've still got
incredibly entertaining
show for you.
That's what you do with all caps?
Yeah.
Yeah, you got
to
scream. Yeah.
It's anger.
Okay.
There's two emotions.
Let me see how you play in quotes.
Centered in anger.
Let me see how you play in quotes.
Watch Catch a Contractor on Spike, starring Adam Carolla as a master carpenter with a taste for vengeance.
Okay, now let's do this next one. Is Brad Pitt.
Okay. It starts with American families who've been conned by low-down, dirty contractors. Corolla and his team locate the cheapskates and bring them to face their mess. The contractors then get a choices. Give back money, come back, fix the work, or the homeowners. We'll see them in court.
Oh, fuck! Oh, where do we go from here? Catch! I got a little Michael Cera, just a little.
Okay.
If it's possible.
Just as these contractors are stumbling around trying to defend their terrible work, Adam Britton and the families to confront the dirtbags who ripped them off, or you know maybe just try to solve things amicably, if at all possible.
You'll cry, you'll re-examine your own haven. What?
It's where justice!
And
comedy me!
To make great television. Oh, Catch a Contractor starring Adam Carolla premieres Sunday, February 28th at 10 or 9 Central. Oh, and an all-new episode of Bar Rescue on Spike.
I'm going to say yeah. Takeshi Contractor now owes us 10 times.
It's going to be difficult for them to make that right.
Right.
It really is. It's beyond
right.
writing a check at this point.
No, they thought they were going to get like a half-ass, like, sort faint enthusiasm.
Wait. Half-ass?
Yeah.
That's what they thought they were going to get?
Yeah, they thought at best they were going to get like a, he'll be, oh, no.
Oh, yeah.
Was that your spit take?
Oh, yeah. Oh, he wet himself. You hurt his feelings so bad, he wet himself.
I throw water on the ground at that suggestion.
I'm just saying, not half-ass, but just like a, and then you got your butt.
Oh, so I normally do the reads in a monotone.
Yeah.
In a bored monotone.
Yeah.
Oh, let's check out this next one for Squareface.
All right, very well.
Space.
Squarespace. With your Squareface.
All right, now you get to do the request.
I do?
Yeah.
Okay.
Who should I read this as?
Okay. Oh, great.
Albert Brooks, okay. Alan Arkin.
I love Arkin. I would love.
Let's take a break to take thanks Squarespace, the all-in-one platform. Is this crazy? That makes it fast and easy to create your own professional website or online portfolio. It's a great word, by the way, portfolio. For sponsoring today's show, not the Today Show. Squarespace is constantly improving their platform with new features, beautiful designs. Oh, honestly, when you look at the designs, there's only one word you could use to describe them, and that's beautiful. And all the style options you need to create a website, I'm going to do my impression of it, tailored to your needs and tastes. Plus, every Squarespace plan is now fully, I can't commit to it. The yelling with the all caps.
It takes a lot out of you.
I'm going to finish this. I'm going to lie down. To support commerce functionality. By the way, a word I'm not fond of, functionality. It's too literal. That means that every single Squarespace.
Let me just take over from here if I can, if you wouldn't mind, Alan.
Peter!
I can't move one eye and read the teleprompter. That's the only problem.
Squarespace customers can now begin selling products online. Restaurateurs, artists, writers, or CEOs. Squarespace is here to power your next great idea, big or small. Start your free trial with no credit card required at squarespace.com. If you decide to sign up for Squarespace, make sure to use the offer code ARKIN. That's not true. Do not use ARKIN. You'll get nothing for that. Try Pollack, P-O-L-L-A-K, that little Jew shit who ripped me off. Get 10% off to let them know that we sent you. Squarespace, everything you need to create, an exceptional website.
You know that there's like people sitting in an office like, does he need to say Squarespace more? Can we pepper in Squarespace?
I don't think 11 is enough.
Four or five more times?
Yeah.
Maybe we use Squarespace as punctuation?
Well, as punctuation? As qualifiers?
I just lost my log.
Oh, no worries. Okay, so let's go back in. Thank you for that, by the way.
Yeah,
that was a little ridiculous. I'm going to watch it on a continuous loop at the house for a while. had you done Brad Pitt prior to SNL? Was that one you brought to the audition?
That was. I could tell that could maybe be my meal ticket if people responded to it in the way that I did.
Right.
Yeah, that's one that comes out of just wanting to be him.
Sure.
Just the run of Seven, 12 Monkeys, Fight Club, like that was just every guy I feel around my age was.
Yeah.
He was kind of the dean for our generation. I feel
Not to mention the first ever
the Brando
to do this with a gun.
Is that true?
In the movie California with a K.
Is that?
You're mean, Early.
Right. So good.
Oh, what are you talking about? Well, you hurt my head.
Oh, man.
Yeah, he was an old. He was an old
in everything.
Yeah, he really is exceptional, and he was an old prospector in California. You're right.
Yeah, he was. All right. I want to take a nap.
Yeah, 12 Monkeys also just.
God.
Are you kidding me?
Well, that's where the buh comes from. It's like, you want to get out? You want to escape? That's sane. That's very sane.
I can help you, monkey.
It's really kind of uncanny. And also, with me, with Alan Arkin or Albert Brooks, especially with Albert Brooks, I give the example. Comedically, I think faster when I'm in his rhythms than in my own.
Absolutely.
How weird is that?
I know exactly what you mean. Yeah, it's an odd thing.
Yeah. And you just want to live in their space a little while. I think that's why it's great to hear you admired Brad Pitt's work so much, that's why the impression sort of started.
Yeah.
Because that happened with me from the beginning, and I think it happens to this day. And they'll say, well, why don't you do something? I don't really give a shit about
yeah.
it.
Yeah. Yeah, I think the best ones come out of, how'd they do that? How'd they get away with that? You
right.
know what I mean?
Right.
Like, that's such a strong choice in that moment that if I tried to make in the most earnest, people would laugh at.
Yeah.
People would laugh if I tried to, you know, do that in a thing. But he fucking gets away with it.
Yeah, or Bastards. Holy
yeah.
fuck.
Yeah. Just Ronaldo Reigns. Yeah, yeah. It's awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I found it interesting in the dossier that you brought all of that to the first audition.
Yes.
They said, come back a second time. You did, in your own words, a little more sweaty that
yes.
second time around, and then did not get the show, and then 1 year later got the phone call saying, oh, wait, maybe we do want to hire you.
Yeah.
Was that the longest year in time after getting that close anyways? Because it kind of seemed like when you talk about it previously, the sense was, I never thought in a million years that from being at Groundlings and being on a sketch and seeing on the chalkboard or whatever backstage, oh, by the way, Lorne Michaels was in the audience, that it would lead to me getting flown out to audition for the show. So because that should have never actually happened,
yeah.
I had to wonder, was it as devastating as someone who their whole life was, this moment has to come, and then it doesn't?
Sure. There's so many shades therein. Like by the time I left MAD,
right.
SNL became a possibility, but in an odd way, a smaller possibility because, oh, have I tainted the waters by doing MAD?
As everyone else before you had.
Yeah, right. But I did it, so maybe why not?
Right.
But if it's ever going to be reality, I need to know what the hell I'm doing. So that was Groundlings. And also at that time, because after MAD, it went back to conventional auditioning.
And 7 or 8 years.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, exactly.
Long
well, you can
time.
Do, you know, level one, level two, back to back. You can bang those out pretty easy at Groundlings. And,
right.
And it's only 4 levels, but the wait for me between 2 and 3 was 1.5 years, I think. And then between 3 and 4 was 2+ years, mm-hmm. just to wait to get that class. But once I was immersed into that process, that became sort of, you know, Valhalla for me. Is like SNL, that'd be the best. And I think the first show I ever got to see live, I got to see SNL live years before, was Andy and Bill's first episode, the season premiere of their first, and they did like an update thing where it was like new guy impression off, that was great. And for me, it was like Hader was just clearly the guy because he did Pacino in that first episode. And it was like, how? He's the guy.
What did Andy do, Nick Cage, or he wasn't ready yet?
No, the joke of the new guy impression off was that Bill was this master.
And Andy was.
And so it was like, you know, is Peter O'Toole? And, you know, and then Andy'd be like, hey, I'm Sylvester Stallone! You know, I'm Rocky! It was very funny.
Right.
And just that, it's just those little moments where like, hey, I got in to see SNL. Maybe it is possible.
Right.
And then seeing, knowing a little bit and seeing Kristen get hired. Like, I was around, like, my friends who were in Sunday Company with Kristen.
At Groundlings. Right.
And, like, seeing her go through the process of auditioning and getting it. And, like, oh, it does happen for people in my circle.
Yeah.
Then there's also, like, no way in hell. You know what I mean? Like there's just no way. So when Lorne came and saw the Sunday Company, we think he was there to look at Nassim, actually, because he did fly her out, and we knew that they were looking for girls at that time.
Right.
But he flew 4 of us out. So, yes, seeing Lorne was there on the board was kind of like, this is the moment you hope you get. Even with doing Groundlings, there's no guarantee for that.
Oh, no, there's thousands
there's
that
thousands.
Never got close.
Exactly. And there's people in the main company, brilliant, talented performers, who just, in the cycle of SNL and the show and what they needed cast-wise, never got the opportunity to be seen.
I don't think they wanted it. I think that's actually the line.
All right.
Yeah, it wasn't the way life goes. It was they didn't want it.
I'll tell them.
Okay.
So that moment comes is a victory, and
yeah.
Holy crap, and I don't know, and you can't help but go like, did he like what I did?
Right.
And he did.
So
and
who did you throw down at the original audition?
I did 8 or 9 impressions. I did Brad Pitt, I did Seth Rogen, I did Paul Giamatti and Dr. Claw having phone sex. I did Jimmy Fallon interviewing Tom Hanks.
So you're saying you also did Tom Hanks?
Yeah.
I'm not sure I've seen anyone do this.
No, I don't.
It's pretty bad. It's not great. It's fun. It's enough.
Is it just the enthusiasm?
100%. It's like, oh my God, I can't believe it. Mr. Tom Hanks is here. So cool. You're like the biggest movie star in the world. I can't believe it. It's so funny. I love that movie you did about the puzzles. What was that?
Well, that was the Da Vinci Code.
Yeah, it is the rhythm.
It's only that.
Yeah.
And I can't be conversational in it at all.
Right.
Just, well, come on, get off of here, Wilson.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's pretty great.
Yeah. So it was like nine. It was like all your A material, right?
Sure.
And I will say that first audition was like, win or lose, I did it. Win or lose, I'm in the space. Lauren said, you're worth taking a look at. Four of us went from Sunday Company. I rented a limo to pick us up at the airport, made like a playlist of like, you know, Jay-Z, Alicia Keys, New York, Frank Sinatra, you know, like we were just blasting it, driving through the Holland Tunnel, like hanging out of the sunroof. And it was a party and it was just like so great and just absorb it because no matter what, wow.
Yeah.
So they fly into Newark then?
You're right. Midtown Tunnel. You're right. Midtown. Same. Thank you.
Okay.
This has been Mr. Geography.
Well, it's just my neck of the woods, bro.
I'm still learning. I'm a West Coast guy, dude.
Again, production notes.
Yeah.
Always correct the guess. Anytime.
Wasn't correct.
There's an
guess.
Opportunity.
I was asking
you're working it out.
He didn't say we flew into JFK and took the Holland Tunnel.
You're so right. And I do take the Holland. I do fly into Newark because we're in Battery Park City.
There you go. See.
Thank you. And now I feel closer to you than maybe anyone ever.
Shall we
you're
take
so right.
this
I'm on your side. Thank you.
No, thank you.
It'll be a better version next time you do. That's all. That's all this is about.
Take two.
Yeah.
We're driving in a truck. God damn it. I said limo the first time, didn't I? Okay. Take it again. It was a party and my pump-up song is listening to, you know, Lose Yourself, 8 Mile, you know, dun, dun, just like fully like I'm just gonna make this as dramatic and fun and everything I want it to be.
Right.
And I did great and I got laughs and I could tell it went well and Lauren came up and shook my hand after the first one and I was like, whatever happens, you know, there's only so much, as you know, is that's in your control. A week or two later, they really liked you. I knew it. They want to fly you back in a week to do 5 new minutes of completely new material. And I'm like, oh, come on. You're only going to see the B team. That's all I can show you. I promise you I did not try to slow play it.
Right.
I promise you I put 6.5 minutes together of what I thought was the best to show you. And also now it's so much more real.
Right.
Like, not only are they looking at you, they're really looking at you.
No, you're fucked.
And so it went from like being in the dressing rooms the first time of like, wow, who sat here? And oh man, that smells like Farley. What is this? And, you know, to like, I know it goes from Michael Cera into the stupid Jamba Juice. I should be doing the Jamba Juice character. What am I doing? They're gonna hate that. I did a fucking musical guy the first time. This is not gonna, like, really in my head.
Should have done that.
And I totally should have done that. Guys, listen, I already gave you my best stuff. I'm just gonna explain how I feel. I'm a human boy, and this is impossible. It's literally the hard. Did you audition?
Yeah.
It's the hardest audition ever.
Hellish.
I mean, you'll appreciate, you know, you've all the auditions you've done in your day. You're in the studio. You're on home base mark where the host says, thanks, you know, we got a great show, stick around. You're standing there. When you do the show, it's not that hard. When you do the show, it's filled with 300 people. Crews are running around. There's sets, there's energy, there's everything. This is, it's completely empty.
Yeah.
The lights, there's only one light on you, so it's freezing because the air conditioning hasn't been burned off by the other, you know, the rest of the grid. And there's a table, like a long picnic table with Lauren and Seth and Marcy, you know what I mean? It's like, it's us, it's here. You start talking and your voice is echoed back over the sound system because there's nothing buffering that or muffling the sound, you know, absorbing the sound waves. And it's awful. You feel so alone. You feel so like, oh, it's just me. And no material provided for me. This is just my stuff. You
and
know?
You don't want to stop talking. You want everything to keep going just in case there's an opening and an empty moment, which you simply can't not survive.
Totally. And your and me, what I did wrong that I changed for the third audition was they want to see, they got to get to know me. They want to see who I am. So in between, I'm going to be funny, I'm going to be charming, and like, thank you. That was weird. And I put my thing on, and okay, I'm a nice guy. I'm really easy to work with. I never complain. I'll always, you know, I'll give you grace whenever you want.
Right.
And the third time was like, so the second time, I feel I kind of psyched myself out a little bit, but they also did not need another white guy, you know, nor do we now. But at that time, they had, you know, Jason, Will, Bill, Andy, you know, they were set. They weren't looking for this type. But even with that, we were told it's no, but not never. And you're on our radar and we really like him. So that was enough of a thing that was like, you know, good for me. I'll take it with a grain of salt, because if I, you know, invest in that, I'll lose my mind and become a crazy person.
Sure.
But I had that concept to know I'm still at the Groundlings. I have another 6 months of Sunday Company. I was lucky enough to get into the main company. Now what I write, I'm going to really watch the show. And now what I write for myself, I'm really going to try to structure to that format.
Yeah.
And I had a year to do that. So Time C was also a little bit, in the most professional way possible, fuck you, you've seen me, here's what I can do. So right. It's like, bit, hold for laugh, because you should be laughing. Move on to the next thing. And I, they have the server where you can watch all your auditions. And you can see the progression. Like, the first one is just happy energy. And the second one is a little shaky and sweaty. And then the third one is like, boom, boom, boom. And Lauren even said, you have a meeting with him. So I auditioned a week later. They flew me out to meet with Lauren. And he's like, you know, your audition was very good. They were all good, but this was very precise, you know. And at the time, I was like, well, I thought the others were precise, but then you sit there from his vantage point, and you're like, oh, he's absolutely right.
Yeah. And once you get into that world, mm-hmm. how about this? Because mm-hmm. I realize we've had the former cast members on. We've not had the active.
Yeah.
And if this is more water, by the way, I've got a beautiful little backup here.
Give me a little taste, man.
Yeah. First one's free. Yeah. If you can, we've heard fragmented bits and pieces. That's, by the way, those of you listening, not the water pouring, but me urinating.
It's such a healthy stream.
It really is.
I gotta tell you.
Into water.
It's not a big package. It's just a huge urethra.
Yeah.
Just like
It's less of a stream.
Like a horse throwing up.
Just like loose skin around a very firm pipe.
That's exactly right. Yeah, very short and stout pipe. I'm not proud.
Yeah.
But just wide opening. What was, as much as you can, walk us through, you did a show last week?
Two weeks ago.
Just, if you wouldn't mind, because we've heard the fragment. Like, for example, in the research, I didn't know about the Tuesday night dinner with the host.
Sure.
So there's got to be, and we've been students and fans of the show our entire life.
Yeah.
Okay, so would you mind walking us through the week?
No.
Okay.
Monday, you'll get a text. Call time for pitch is usually around 4:30.
Which means the guest host.
The guest host is going to be in Lauren's office. All of the cast and the writers will file into Lauren's office on the 17th floor, mm-hmm. corner office. Sit on the floor in couches and chairs, and then go around the room and pitch one or two one-line ideas. The real goal being, make the room laugh, show the host we're thinking about them, put a face to the name and voice, and show, hey, this is going to be fun. This is going to be a fun time.
And is there the hope that the guest host is going to go, ooh, I like that?
Sometimes. There's equally the fear that they'll do that. Like, this is such a ridiculous sketch and, like, would never work, but I want to say it because it'll make people laugh. Mm. And then it's like, I love that. And you're like, oh, I had a real idea I was going to work on, and we're only allowed two, and now I have to do this because it got endorsed by the host.
So you learn pretty quick to be careful.
You do.
Yeah.
You do. Monday is such an odd thing because it's equal parts stressful because you're surrounded with everybody. You're, in a way, performing for everybody,
which
for all your
quite
peers.
Quite rare that everyone's together.
Exactly. And it means nothing, too. Really, like, when it comes down to it, what will be read on Wednesday is in no way reflected by what's said on Monday. So it's a lot of, it's much ado about nothing, you know.
And you're also still pretty hungover from Saturday night.
Yeah.
You've only had 54 hours.
Sure.
That's not enough.
For sure. No, and they'll go late. They'll go, I guess there was a group that went two shows back, went till noon on Sunday, hanging. Till noon on Sunday. Yeah, I could never.
I made that mistake once.
Did you? Yeah, you hung and did the whole thing.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah, it's it throws off your schedule. It's like nothing else in so many ways. But
at very earliest, you're getting out of there 4:35 a.m. just from the Saturday night dinner.
Yes, after exactly. Show, earliest is 4. Yeah, yeah. Earliest if you're putting
saying, guys,
time.
I really got to get out of here. Exactly. It's 4:05 a.m.
Exactly.
If you're being the party pooper.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So true, yeah. So you show up, if the call time's 4:30, you'll maybe show up at 3:30 because you know people are already starting to plan writing appointments. So you'll go around, and if you haven't texted somebody, of, hey, I'd like to do this week, find time, and you'll have to go in and be, what are you working on, and would you want to do something about this? And then there's topical. And that's basically for the writers, but the cast, a lot of the cast sits in, and up until now, Seth has led that. And hey guys, welcome back, great show, I thought that was a good response. Hey, did you read that article about that? And hey, what about this thing in politics? That's crazy, and somebody should do something about that. And anybody see movies or TV shows? And kind of shoot the breeze. Then we go into pitch, we do pitch, then we come out. Some people start writing or trying to outline stuff Monday night. My personal process is to like kind of check in with people and try to sort of lay bare bones of what my Tuesday night will be, and then maybe go out to dinner with people and hang out, because a lot of it is, as Mr. Hank said, the hang. And then Tuesday for me is Tuesday's writing day. So I show up around 2 in the afternoon. I try to schedule anywhere from 2 to 3 appointments, and they need to be, for me, about 3 or 4 hours to really kind of get something done. And a sketch should be, if it's a commercial, it can be, you know, 6 or 8 pages. If it's a sketch, it should be about 10, but not much longer than that. And you write from 2 in the afternoon. I write from 2 in the afternoon, and the average I go home is around 5 or 6 a.m. on Wednesday. Tuesday nights this season, I'm lucky enough to be chosen for every host dinner. So lucky for it.
'Cause it's a break from the writing?
No, because it's not, yeah, it takes you, like, you're right, getting somewhere, and then at 8:30, like, host dinner. And they bring in a dinner, too, around 7 on the 17th floor in the writer's room. But, yeah, you go to the host dinner, it's always at the same place, and it's Lorne and the host and a couple people from the talent department, and then 5 or 6 of the cast. And
you heard about these host dinners your first year.
Yeah, I went to maybe 2 or 3 my first year.
Which is already remarkable, because as new guy...
I think they try to give everybody a little taste. Yeah, I think they're like, hey, you know, this is what it's like, and how are you going to fare? And it is that whole thing where nothing's ever said, but there's so much being communicated, you know? I feel like a victory is your first dinner. You're like... actually, I read an article about that, and this happened, and this happened, and I found this funny about it, and the table laughs, and then you say nothing else. That's like a great job at that host dinner. You killed at that host dinner.
Yeah.
They're different. It's very much depends on who the host is and the type of person they are. Sometimes if it's somebody familiar who's back, it's very relaxed, and people are having their own conversations. If it's someone who's new and timid or a little quiet, it's very focused on them, and we're all trying to make them feel welcomed and excited. Then you go back, you write, you have to be back on Wednesday by around 2:30 for the table read. Table read is the 40-odd sketches that have been written the nights previous.
Why you stayed up till 6 a.m., we find out Wednesday at 2:30.
Exactly right. So it's done in halves, like sketches 1 to 20. It's the first half. You take a 15-minute break. Sketches 21 through 40, second half.
And these are read?
Read out loud.
By the cast.
A huge conference table. The cast sits around with Lorne and the hosts. And then the writers are around us. The production heads sit behind us. And we read through the sketches. And
for a lot of the cast who don't write, or all the cast write?
Everybody writes.
But still, you're seeing sketches that you've never seen before that other people wrote you into.
Exactly right, yeah. And you can go in a little earlier, as I do, and like it's all on the server, and you can kind of scrim. And
so it's
like,
not a cold read.
Yeah, I have to play Joe Buck. Let me look up what Joe Buck's like, and that sort of thing. But it is, yeah, it's coldish. And then from that, Lorne goes into his office and looks it over, and then brings in the producers and the head writer, and then brings in the host, and they discuss. and then you hang out. The cast and writers will all go to their offices and hang out and like, God damn it, my sketch didn't play, or hey, that was hilarious. They better pick that, or like.
Well, that's why I asked about the cold read, because yeah. a lot of the people who stayed up till 6 a.m. are mm-hmm. counting on other cast members who've not seen the sketch yet.
Yes.
To hit the ball just as deep as the people in the room
sure.
who wrote it.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems like it is quite precarious in terms of how important it is to score at that Wednesday read
yeah.
before Lauren and everyone gathers in the room.
Yes,
afterward.
There's so
kind of
much...
have one shot at it the first time, and yeah. then you just keep, the rule is the rule. If it doesn't get through, try to get in a couple of weeks.
If it played well enough, maybe you can tweak it and add some new jokes to surprise the room.
Mm-hmm.
If it bombed...
Forget it. Let it go.
You shouldn't... I'm that way. Even if it doesn't get picked, it's rare that I'll bring something back. I'm kind of like, all right, fine, leave it, move on. But if it bombed, you better do some major retooling. But like, you could get a laugh. Like, if the voice gets a laugh and then the sketch goes nowhere, you're like, okay, people like that character. I need to find a different setting or
right.
scenario.
And how about the feeling of the first sketch you worked on that first year that went through that Wednesday read and made it to the dress?
So my first sketch I ever got on was like my fourth episode with Emma Stone, and it was the French dance thing, and that was what I was performing when Lauren came to Sunday Company. That's what he saw.
Yeah, that was something you were already doing.
Yeah.
So that was pretty cozy and comfortable.
Yeah, but it was a really great kind of like the stars aligned with Emma being huge SNL fan, excited to be there, and I'm like, hey, I'm new, and her being very empathetic to that. And saying like, yeah, what do you need me to do? And like, will you rehearse this dance with me? And she's like, totally. And that was like a good moment, because that's most things that play at the table are things that you can sit and read out loud and people will laugh.
Right.
So it's mostly jokes. And that's a very physical, visual thing. So I got up and a first-time host who's, you know, she's 19, 20 at the time maybe.
And this is a Wednesday?
Wednesday with everybody staring at you with, you know, she took a leap of faith with me, and it paid off and went pretty well. Because I could tell it was something that she would maybe be into. But that was, if I'm honest, probably me knowing that there's not a lot of physicality on the show right now. And this is something that I can kind of lick and put my stamp on that will be like, oh, that's Terrence's thing. Because I have pretty good unique impressions, and then if I do physical, big production things.
That is the thing, by the way. How astute, because it is the thing, and when I think about Will Ferrell,
mm-hmm.
I think initially what set him apart in watching that documentary recently was the cheerleaders was the first thing, and that couldn't have been more physical.
Yeah.
Where he really was like, whoa, what is this?
Yeah.
And how astute to make that decision. Oh, the physical thing.
Yeah.
It's lacking.
Astute-ish in that it is of me, you know what I mean? It's not like I was like, I need to learn it. It's like, this is kind of what I do anyway. This is what I like to do. I think I can do
right.
a few of the things in different forms that people are doing, but certainly not any better than them. So this is something that will be mine. This can be my little plot of land. And that, and then like I got the animatronic thing on, the Maryville thing when Jim Carrey hosted, which was like, he's like my hero.
My brother and I watched SNL every week, and
yeah.
when that sketch aired, I remember he called me the next day, he was like, who's that new guy, Taron?
Yeah.
He was great in that animatronic thing. And I was like, yeah, I know.
Yeah.
He's phenomenal.
Oh, thanks.
He was Stonky and or Blitz.
Right. I want to say Stonky.
I want to say it too.
I want to say that. Will you let me say that?
I
booked Stonky.
Yes, you did.
That moment. I mean, that's like an SNL. That's captured in time. I did a Brasky this season.
Ching. Yeah.
That's in amber and yeah. millions of years from now, you know, Dr. Hammond will pull that out and recreate, you know, Terran's SNL land.
Yeah.
You know, Killam Park.
And he will spare no expense.
He will spare no expense.
That's like, it's a physical thing. If you've seen it, we're like animatronics that are maybe like cursed or possessed. And it's my hero. Jim Carrey, like, is my hero. I was the Mask for Halloween. I was the Riddler. I was Ace Ventura. You know what I mean? Like, he was the guy.
Yeah.
That's the first on the playground. All righty then. And everybody laughs.
Yeah.
And, like, Taron does it the best. You know, like, that's...
yeah.
He was the guy.
Sure.
That was, like, mine. So now I'm here. And this thing gets picked. And it's a physical thing with Jim Carrey. And I have the best time rehearsing it, because you're locked in place, and how much, you know, padding, how much can you rework this,
yeah.
you know, like moving like a robot. So it goes up a dress. Bill's to my right. Love and respect Bill. Jim's to my left.
We're like hunkered down under this like plywood wall, like 3-foot wall. And like, yeah, so how does it go? We come up, we do that. Yeah, and then I grab her. Yeah, exactly, okay.
And we come up and we do the first one and we do it. And then after, as we do it, you can tell the audience is so into it. Big laughs. We lower back down, applause break. And now it's like, I'm
hunched down behind a wall in 8H as a cast member on SNL. People are applauding for the sketch I wrote. Look over at Bill, he's like, it's killing me, that's awesome. Look over at Jim Carrey, and he's like, you know, way to go. And it's like,
Take me now.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it doesn't, that's such a great example of opportunity, the work, mm-hmm. the meeting your hero, not a disappointment, making him proud, getting to work side by side. It's all of those things that's the best of what that show could possibly offer.
Exactly.
Holy shit.
Yeah.
That's pretty fucking sweet.
Yeah.
Good. But also in the dossier, it showed how much of a fan of the show you were, how literally
my
up to
life.
Speed on every single aspect, like the rest of us who are just straight up fans that have seen every interview. And
well, you'll appreciate this then. I just this last week, the Melissa McCarthy show on Thursday, sat down with Jim Miller for the updating of Live from New York.
Oh, wow.
And I walked in, I got that email and I was like, what? And I walked in and he was like in the green room and he's like, hey, thank you for doing this. I was like, man, I have read your book so many times on so many different toilets. And that is the greatest compliment I can give you.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm just a student of it. And for me, it was Eddie Murphy's Best Of. Like that was my, I want to watch that again. That was my first relationship with the show.
Yeah.
And then awareness from Lovitz on.
Right. Well, I mean, those of us who watch the show and watch someone like yourself break out, we want to instantly think, this was a perfect fit. This was opportunity meeting all of the preparation possible.
Yeah, yeah.
And then to find out in the dossier that you had the setback also of, hey, you're on a radar, you didn't, not this year, kid. Mm-hmm. Just adds to the whole thing. And then how you settled in being the new guy, and that this happened on the fourth show, you just, I mean, that's also part of this sort of masterful. But prior to that, your then girlfriend is on a hugely successful television show.
Yes.
And you guys are together how long before you get the official call that you're moving to New York?
Yeah, so when I got it,
2010.
We were together for 5 or 6 years at that point.
Yeah. So this is one of those life discussions.
And the beauty of that situation, of what could be seen as a setback, is we now have a year to discuss how would we execute on this.
Right.
To let it soak into our bones, to be aware of the concept. If I get this, there's no way I'm saying no. You have to be here in LA contractually. So I'm going to be flying back and forth. And what's that going to mean for us and for our family? And
she's 3 weeks on, 1 week off, and so are you?
She's consistent. We're a little more warped. We'll do like 2 on, 3 off, or 3 on, 1 off, 2 on, 2 off. You know?
And of course, I don't tell you in advance.
Yeah, you maybe know a few months in advance. Right. Yeah, but you know basically from September to May, you're doing the season.
Right.
Everything about my career, and I would not change a thing, has kind of been this. You know what I mean? Every now and then a little bump or a little dip, but it's just steady enough. There was nothing overnight about me. There was nothing, you know, I've been around the industry. I've seen people explode overnight. I've seen people, you know, disappear into oblivion. I've seen it. I've seen a lot enough in my 31 years to be beyond grateful, beyond appreciative for every moment and soak it in and as best you can, especially in a chaotic environment like SNL, try to compose yourself and try to be like...
Also considering you're still technically in the pocket.
Yeah, no, I mean, well, this is my beginning in a way, right?
Yeah.
My first audition was when I was 5 years old, and at 31, it's like I can feel this season is kind of like I have the respect of the show.
Right.
Now I'm writing for fun as opposed to writing for what will get on.
Also the passing, as it were, of the torch yeah. baton from Bill Certainly. And from Sudeikis Jason, and from yeah. Kristen.
Absolutely, absolutely.
And new guys, six new people added, then another
yeah.
one
yeah.
who are now looking to you as...
Yeah, I guess. I'm trying my best to kind of embrace that and not go, no, don't look at me, no.
You
because
have to
there is
embrace.
A reality of that, in that it's Keenan, now it's Keenan, Bobby, Nassim, me, Vanessa J. You know what I mean? And then in that, and in the role I play on the show, I have the ability to set an example and set a tone of how sure. to behave and how to go through the process as best as possible. And so I'm trying to own that. That's not in my nature,
right.
but I'm trying to.
That's why it was so surprising to see in the dossier how mean and despicable you are to the new people. And so is that for you just fun? Is that just funny?
Cite me examples.
Well,
I will not.
Thing,
I plead the fifth. I will not incriminate
that
myself.
Whole thing. How you tricked Beck Bennett into thinking he was going to do a musical show in D.C. and then you sold him into slavery.
Yeah, right.
That
I see
was
what's happening
fucked
now.
Up, Darren.
Okay, no, I see what's
that
happening. You're confusing my very prestigious hot film career with my respectable SNL resume.
Yeah.
Yeah, I just you brought up your documentary about being. Do you have to be miserable to be funny? I don't consider myself to be miserable. I've had a really great life, and I think I'm a pretty nice guy. Of course, I feel like I'm always concerned if I have to say that, you know. But no, am I insecure? Absolutely. Do I get down on myself? Definitely. There's doubt. Then there's also huge ego, and I want to be the best, and I want people to think I'm great. But I think I'm able to keep them in check. And what's most important, I feel, especially being on SNL and being in a generation where nobody is on the show who wasn't born after the show was created. So almost wow. everybody who's on it is a fan.
Sure. Grew up with it.
There's no reason we shouldn't at least try to find a moment a week to be like, holy crap!
Yeah.
How cool is this?
Right.
You know? And a lot of my favorite comedy is victimless, is silly, is nonsensical. I'm like, right. I'm a huge Conan guy for that reason. You know, he says the
Will
comedy should mean
Will Ferrell comes
anything.
To mind.
Just everybody can enjoy. Right. Or not, you know, and I definitely have strong opinions, you know, Eddie Redmayne included. But I more enjoy when everybody can enjoy it and kind of the tearing down and there's a place for that and when that's done well, when it's sort of like that surgical like yeah. cutting right where you're supposed to, there's nothing that'll make me laugh harder. But for the most part, I hope to keep this era as it seems to be a very positive, happy, supportive environment as much as it can be
right.
in that environment.
Right. All the more reason to start discussing an exit strategy.
Let's go.
From the show.
What do you got? What do you got for me?
Is this year four?
Can I be your third?
No. I'm not even beginning to suggest where you should go.
Okay.
But I think it's important to start talking about when you're leaving the show.
I just got here, please.
I don't mean this show.
Oh, okay.
I mean SNL. No, we've got another hour and a half.
Okay. I got to beat Hanks. I got to beat him.
Well, we'll see about that.
People want to listen to me more than Tom Hanks, right?
It's got to be, because we do this thing every year in Kansas City where Sudeikis is from, mm-hmm. Along with Rob Riggle and Paul Rudd.
Stone Street.
And and this last one in Ham, yeah. And this last one was right before Sudeikis announced.
No, wow.
Yeah, it was one of those things where when we asked him, he was like, yeah, I thought it was clear, but I guess I have to make some sort of formal announcement.
Well, because Kristen's last show was a...
Yeah,
was
Leave No Doubts. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And it has a little bit of the Firm to it mm-hmm. in that no one actually gets out.
Right. Great movie, great cast.
Sure. But it seems to me when you've gone through the phases that you have and you're yep. in the middle of yeah. it, if it's year four, There are people who didn't Phil Hartman do 12 and didn't.
I think Hammond.
Hammond is one who did.
Yeah. Hammond is the long one.
Like 14.
Meadows was the next one.
Next one. Yes. Kevin Nealon was on a long time.
Oh, Daryl has it the most, and then Seth, though.
Seth. Yeah, Seth's he's been there a while.
Who is the new showrunner in absence of Seth or head writer?
The co-head writers are Colin Jost, who's taking over for Update.
That's who it was.
And Rob Klein.
Rob Klein.
Yeah.
So Sophie's choice, one of them has to die. What are you going to do?
Colin Jost.
Sure. He's gone.
Take him.
Yeah. Take him. Sooner.
Take my girl. Take my girl.
You were once, I want to jump around a little bit. You were once asked to describe what makes someone a New Yorker, because until SNL, you hadn't.
Right.
By listing the following. Someone who complains about noise, weather, limited space, being around people, and wouldn't live anywhere else. Now that you've been there a while,
yeah,
is there an update? What makes somebody a New Yorker? Those are the things.
It feels right.
Yeah,
it feels pretty good. I also like. I don't know. You know, I haven't lived in New York for the last 3.5 years,
right.
and will only start living there full time next season.
When your family moves out.
Exactly. Yeah. So that's exciting, and that worked out pretty perfectly as well. And trying to get comfortable and not feeling the pressure to say yes to every hang, every event, everything, you know, now that I'm kind of, you know, pretty comfortable in the show, I think as comfortable as you can be, my family will be there and it'll be easier to be like, I'm going home and I'm going to see the wife.
Yeah.
How about that? How about our meeting, which was so awesome for me?
Well, this is one of the things I wanted to ask. You're guest starring on the show.
Oh, on her show?
On her show.
I am. I just finished this past week, yeah.
Or did you mean meeting me?
Meeting you, yeah. I mean meeting you.
Oh, stop.
Forget her.
I hate it when the guest brings
it
back around to me.
Till death do us part.
Yeah. It was on the street when the two of you were together in that odd moment, because it must have been...
I think it was my first season. It may have been my second.
I think it was your first.
I think it was my first, because we lived at 54th and 7th when I moved there, because I didn't know any better, and I could walk to work, which was great. And you must have been going to or coming from Caroline's, I would presume.
Were you staying at the London Hotel?
We were 54th and 7th. We were kitty corner to it in the apartment building.
That's where I was coming from.
Southwest corner. Oh, really?
Coming
from the London? Well, like we're walking down. I think we're going to a Broadway show, and Kobe gets recognized as she does. And her fans are always the nicest. That's been the great thing about How I Met Your Mother, is that it's like just a nice show with nice people, like with a nice 8 million people who like it.
Yeah.
And everybody who comes up is like, I don't mean to bother you, I just want to say I love the show. So it's always that. And she was having a moment of that, and like, do you mind taking a picture? And like, sure. And I hold the purse. Up comes Kevin Pollak, who I love, and literally grabs my arm and says, "You're a genius." And I was like, ditto. That's all I could say. And then you like keep up the great work and walked off. And it was just the coolest.
It was your first season for sure.
It was the coolest moment. Yeah. It was so awesome.
Well, I'm sure it was. I wish I could return the compliment. I remember it being awkward.
It felt like a have to for you. obligatory.
I thought, I'm going to throw this kid a bone and keep moving. No, listen, you know, I'm glad for whatever that moment was. It was a surprise, because New York is one of those towns where you could see, you know, the president of the United States walking next to a homeless guy. It's just everyone's, you know, it's like the back lot of Warner Brothers.
Yeah.
Oh, there's an alien walking with a centurion.
Yeah.
To the commissary.
Right.
So it was more of the just explosion of what the fuck, the two of you just happened to be there.
Yeah.
But in terms of you in a potentially more impactful meeting, being a guest star on her show, and then getting yourself some.
No, man, I've been plowing that for since before the series got picked up.
I see.
Yes.
Nice, bro. Up high.
I got a guest star being her dude. That it was a nice, like, I'm out of work, and they kind of throwed me a bone.
Oh, so you guys were together beforehand?
Yes, yeah.
I was also not in the dossier.
I had shot a pilot that year called Nobody's Watching. created by Bill Lawrence.
Who went on to do Scrubs.
He's Scrubs, Cougar Town, doing all that good stuff.
And that's the other thing in here, which we'll get to, was how that becomes then a web series.
Yeah, that was weird. That was a weird thing. But yeah, Bill and Neil Goldman, Garrett Donovan, who worked on Scrubs, and then they worked on Family Guy. They've done a bunch of great stuff. They ran Community for a while. And I shot that. There were two leads, myself and a fellow actor who was a Canadian gentleman and a very good friend of Kobe Smulders, and invited her, our pilot. It was such a crazy, great, I was really excited about it. It was one of the few times where I read the pilot and I was like, this is the one I hope I get. And it happened, but it was half single cam, half multicam. The concept was a reality show, but it was a scripted show. Mm. It's very meta. And so he invited her to the live taping. She was there, and I guess we met that night. But I don't remember.
That's my favorite response. I seem to recall, if you insist.
It's, you know, it's like a pilot taping live, and everybody's coming up and going, great job, great job, great job, which is very nice.
And you're not even listening when you're saying nice to meet you.
Yeah, exactly. I'm like, oh man, did they get that? Did they really get that scene? I feel like I could have done that better. Is this show gonna be it? Is this gonna be the break? And then a month later, at a birthday party, my friend Paul Campbell, who introduced us and was the co-star with me.
The Canadian fella?
Canadian
fella. The aforementioned?
Exactly. He said, come to this birthday party. It's the last time we can hang before I go back to Vancouver. And I went to the birthday party and met this beautiful, lovely woman named Kobe. And it was pretty immediate. It was like clear that this is maybe going to be a thing. And it was sort of passively flirtatious.
Sure.
Through other people where you're talking and like, oh yeah, and I'm sure you must, like you seem like a really pretty person. You seem like you could have been a model.
You too have a normal name.
Yeah, but she, yeah, exactly. Hey, you're free, how was that? And then her saying, you know, oh, I shot this pilot, and she chimed me in, like he was so great in it, he's so funny. And then that night, let's exchange numbers. And she's like, yeah, well, I got this pilot that shoots next week. Like, oh, good luck with that. Do you want to go out sometime? And we kind of set up our date for that Monday night, which was the night after the table read for How I Met Your Mother's pilot episode. So she did the pilot episode table read. We went on our first date. Went very well.
Hello. Is the caller there?
Wink, wink, nudge, nudge. And she's like, this is a thing. I like you. I'm shooting this pilot. It's important. I want to be able to focus on it. So don't feel like I'm blowing you off if you don't hear from me the rest of the week. Totally understand. The next day, hey, I got off early. Do you want to hang? And we hung out every night that week.
Right.
So like that first date. And then this past week, just did my final guest star on the show.
Right.
The third to last episode. And happened to be in town for the final table read, because the last two are one episode that will air as an hour. And oh man, that was emotional.
Yeah.
That was crazy. Just the room, just everybody, like the ambient noise was, you know, that's room tone. it's crazy, 9 years.
Yeah.
And it has been this sort of, this structure for our lives together, you know, like, if we're in school, we know where we're going to have to be in August. She starts in August and then to March, and we know we can have a vacation around here, and now that's done. And fortunately, we're going into another structure, which is now my show, but it's been our family. It's been our extended family, and it's so not just a... Because it's such a sweet, it's like the little show that could, it got better and better and better, and I know like people in my circle are like, wow, 9 years, it's been on that long? Oh man, well that's great, way to go. But I'm like, no, it's so much more than that. It's our lives together, don't you understand? We'll never be on stage 22 again. Do you understand? Crafty's closing shop. Crafty's gone.
Yeah,
it's significant. So we're dealing with that. It's a big.
No one will understand. No, absolutely not.
Yeah.
Well, she must be excited, and as you both must be excited about the new venture, because for the rest of us who've sort of been fans of your both, as a, but also you want couples to do well when they're struggling, and then hitting the mark just so well. Her with her show, you with yours. You know, we don't know you, but we want the best for you.
Oh, thanks.
There's something weird about show business couples that when you like both of them, you just want everything to work.
Yeah.
And it never does. It just never does.
We're doomed. Yeah.
I mean, listen, it does every now and then.
Yeah.
Kevin Bacon and Kara Sedgwick, a great example. Yeah.
Kurt and Goldie.
Tom and Rita.
Let's just name them all. You know? There's got to be at least 1,700 more.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Bert and Lonnie.
Who?
What?
Bert,
yeah. No? Bert and Lonnie?
Don't tell him. Don't tell him. My wife is the kindest, most selfless, wonderful, funny, goofy, fucking hot person I've ever met. Yeah. And so I feel good about it. I feel good about it.
Yeah.
Never say never, but I think it's a
yeah, no, deal. I mean, it's amazing.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, no, I'm not pointing out, do you realize how ridiculous this is and it's over tomorrow?
Yeah.
I mean, you're in the pocket of the show and of life.
It's a good time, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a great time. And we did it. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, we did four years of being on the other side of the country from each other.
And you can't help but, as a observer, or, you know, assume life just will continue to dole out the disappointments, because that's what life is. Mm-hmm. And there's going to be those frustrations when you're under the same roof, let alone on opposite ends of the country, and all you can do is be on that phone.
Yes.
I'm sure you guys just text your love to each other.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm sure you don't actually.
We were born in '82.
Get on the phone.
You know.
But yeah, there's got to be a sense of holy shit. Whatever the worst part of our difficult nature of maintaining two lives and careers on opposite ends of the country.
Yeah.
At least that part, we succeeded somehow. I mean,
absolutely.
That, yeah. You can't fuck it up now.
I know.
If you do, it's on you.
Challenge accepted.
Yeah. Yeah.
Nobody tells me I can't.
How much fun is it for you and Paul to go on Comedy Bang Bang? We love the Comedy Bang Bang and devoted to it. Listening to a moment of it a little earlier today.
We may or may not be involved with Earwolf.
They may in fact be our...
The wolf dead.
Yeah.
I've been a Bang Bang fan myself for a long time, so when Scott asked me to do it originally, I said yes, please, and knew that Paul was around and suggested him, because Paul Britton is one of the funniest people I've ever met. He and I got hired together. We shared an office for the first season, and I think I can speak for him and say there's mutual love, or he's just a great, great actor.
Sure, I'm sure both are true.
Yeah. We all have our highs and lows, but he tickles my funny bone.
Yeah.
Paul. And so.
But the two of you together, also, the chemistry there is pretty amazing. He was involved in a sketch that recurred once, maybe twice.
Windermere?
The Kings of Catchphrase Comedy.
Oh, yes. Yes.
That for Jamie.
And there was a third one that didn't air, and I'm very familiar with that one, too.
Yeah, there was one at the table read most recently that didn't get picked, like a final send off for Seth. That was pretty great, too. They're pretty great. Funky boy! Yes,
I go with them quite a bit.
Yeah.
What's the I ask
in
for?
In these shoes?
I ask for his character, Paul's character in particular. Yes. What is it I ask for?
I go to your Sonic restaurant, I ask for Koshecki. They say the washroom is that way. Oh, funky boy! I just heard the little thing. I know all of them.
Yeah. Yeah, Seth did the Boston.
Boston Powers.
Yeah.
Do I make you honey, baby?
Yeah. It's really fun. Yeah, I think it's Bobby, Paul, and Christine Nangle wrote the first one of those, and then variations of that coupling ever since. He's so funny. He's so funny, and in such a great, kind of like, subtle way, too. You know, I don't know if you remember Sex Ed Vincent.
No.
The old video that he did. It's so great. Like, he's like basically giving an orientation on sex consultation.
Sure.
He's like, yeah, I'll teach you about sex. But he's, you know, very, very bad at it, as seems to be the very loose premise of every sketch on SNL ever.
Right.
This person's bad at this thing. It's worth looking up, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I mentioned beforehand about getting Jenny Slate for the documentary. It was pretty great, and she talked a lot about that dream coming true and getting SNL, and for her instantly knowing this is a bad fit, and then ultimately getting fired from the show. and what it meant to her to get fired and how it became this wonderful springboard to better stuff that yeah. she felt she was so much more suited at doing. So when you do share an office like that with Paul, mm-hmm. and you're coming in at the same time,
yeah,
and you stay and he doesn't, does it just help you realize how rare it is for things to go correctly? Mm-hmm. Because it seems like for every great story, there are 17 of, it should have worked the same way for this person.
Yes. Yeah, definitely. There was so much selfishly to take away from Paul's situation. It was a surprise. It was genuinely a surprise to me. I still kind of don't feel that it was the right decision.
Right.
Because at that time, he'd really started to get, he had like this recurring character, Lord Windermere, and he was starting to be integrated more, you know, and I just think he is a unique voice in comedy, a strong, unique voice, which is a precious, precious thing.
Especially on that show.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. And so very hard, because there's definitely like this, a sibling bond with the people you come in with,
yeah.
like Vanessa and Jay. Very much feel like my siblings, like family. So all I can speak for is my side of it. I would imagine it was probably pretty hard on Paul's side. So it was sad, it was heartbreaking. It made me very angry at the show.
Yeah.
I got real angry, like, I don't even, what's the fucking point then? What's the point?
Right.
They don't even know, see, you know, it was a lot of that. Some survival guilt. And then also, sort of relief, like, oh, Paul's one of the funniest people I've ever met, and if this show is not keeping him, it doesn't mean I'm not funny if I don't make it on the show. You right. know what I mean? It was that realization of like, oh, the show has a type and has its needs and is subjective as is any form of
yeah.
comedy.
Yeah.
And if I get fired, better people than me have been fired from this show.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. No, I could say that's absolutely true. In fact, we should go down that list right
Great.
Now,
Give it
too.
To me. Yeah, no,
these
please.
Are the people
Flock
that
me.
Are better than you that were fired.
Terry Sweeney.
Terry Sweeney.
Yes, thank you.
Danny Dillon.
Yes, Danny Dillon. Thank you.
Well, that whole season, besides like Lovitz, was in...
Chris Rock.
Sure. RDJ.
Yep.
RDJ.
Chris Michael. Rock. Janine Garofalo.
Yeah.
Gottfried.
Well, listen, I mean, technically, I think Sandler, Farley, and all those guys were let go before...
They absolutely were let go.
Yeah, yeah. So, yeah, it's crazy.
It doesn't
just
work out
grateful.
For...
Yeah.
Yeah. Also, it just seems like an amazing university. It seems like everyone yes. that's come out of there comes out of there.
Mm-hmm.
So whether it's leaving prematurely or at the end of staying too long at
yeah.
the dance, there's... You know, it turns out it's just an incredible place for an education.
Definitely.
And for a lot of graduating alumni, they speak of it as this amazing moment in time. And it seems like the people who have come here that are former cast members say, you know, if you had any message for people who are active members, is be present.
Mm-hmm.
There's been various phases where the cast members were, you did a movie in the... In the hiatus? Oh, yeah,
yeah
me,
right.
me too.
Yeah.
You know, that stuff.
Sure.
And one of the things in the dossier that you spoke to, which I found it refreshing because I hadn't heard much of it, was being a fan of the show, you always heard about this competitive cesspool.
Yes.
And how Lauren was a genius at getting people to compete against each other as a way to bring out the best in them. And while that may be true in a lot of cases, it's obviously not true for everyone.
Yeah.
And that your experience thus far has not been in this competitive cesspool. Sure, everyone is competitive with themselves to get mm-hmm. the best possible on the show.
Yes.
And, as you mentioned, 40 sketches on Wednesday.
Yeah.
How many end up being in the show?
8 get produced, I think. Like, on the live show, you see about 8.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's pretty remarkable.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's almost a fluke when something gets through.
Yes.
And then from dress to the live
another,
also.
Another, yeah, 3 or 4 get cut. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. So, like, 12 to 14 are picked to be produced, and then about 8 survive, 7 or 8.
It also seems like some cast members, if not all, in their first year, at least, have to go through... Literally not being written into 3 or 4 shows in a row.
Yeah.
Did you have that phase?
I did. I definitely did. I started that way. I like my first show. I think I had like one line as the JetBlue flight attendant, sure. Which was the story that week.
I think we all remember that.
And then had, I would say maybe had two shows that first season where I like was only in the Good Nights, maybe only one, something like that. I think they always try to pepper you in somewhere if that's the case. But the best lesson in that for me was one of those weeks where I had nothing. There's a knock at my dressing room door, and Fred Armisen comes in. And he's like, yeah, I'm not really in anything this week either. And I'm like, you're Fred Armisen. He's like, it happens the whole time. It just happens. And it's the truth. The people there and the personalities there are no huge assholes right now. There just aren't, which is amazing. And I credit Seth Meyers, you know, with that because...
And Tina before him.
Yeah. I think they really, like, they want funny, obviously, but also they don't want jerks. Because it is just competitive. It's only competitive. There's 17 cast members right now and as many writers. So, you know, 40-ish creative minds trying to land 8 spots a week.
Vying for 42 minutes.
Exactly, yeah. So it's just competitive. And you certainly are like, why they pick that one over mine? You know, you have those moments. But everybody that's on the show right now has the ability to step back and be like, hey, that was great, way to go, which is huge. It's awesome.
What a different experience.
Yeah, to be able, very much so.
Most of those work environments should be kind of a supportive, but they,
yeah,
you know, the rest of us who are just fans have always heard.
Yeah, I think there's been the I've heard that there's been the other.
And I think you're right. The fish always stinks from the head. Mm-hmm. Either the person in charge, be it Tina or Seth or whoever,
yeah.
wants a happy camp or they don't care.
Yeah.
Or they're just not happy themselves, which has obviously been a big part of the show in various camps over the years. Mm-hmm. You've seen the show. You know what it means to play Who Tweeted. I believe the time has come for you to wager and risk... nothing but possibly win. Here he comes, your host, Sammy Sam Levine.
Oh, it's getting real now.
Celebrities have so much to say.
Who tweeted?
Is the game we're gonna play.
Coming up afterwards saying, I've got to stand.
Gangrene. At some I have point, gangrene in my foot.
Seriously, my ass fell asleep. This deep conversation with Taryn.
Sorry.
This is wonderful.
SNL in particular, people are always like, oh, sorry to ask. I'm like, I will talk about this all day. I love this job, and I have this job,
oh, yeah.
and I will talk about it.
Like, when I go as a guest just to watch the show, mm-hmm. like, it's all I can do to talk about for the next month.
Yeah.
Is what I saw behind the scenes, yeah. and, oh, and they had this sketch, and they pulled that line at the last minute, and you wouldn't believe it. And,
totally. Yeah.
It's
one of those American institutions also, mm-hmm. quite frankly. What are we, 30, you're 37?
39.
39.
1975, oh my God, you're right.
Yeah.
That doesn't really exist in any most art forms that you can think of.
Yes.
Maybe there's the 40th year of the Playboy Jazz Festival. You know, one of those ongoing things that people have reunions for and yeah. previous casts and stuff. You know, when it becomes that historic, forgive mm-hmm. us for...
No.
For, you know, going on and on and on. But yeah. Sammy!
But that's not what I came here to talk Woo-hoo. About. I could do that from my seat.
Please tell us more.
I came here to do a little game called Who Tweeted. Are you familiar with the rules?
Why can't you do this from your seat?
We've had that discussion. If you knew how many times I have asked Sam, do not get
You're
up.
Standing very close to me.
I'm closer to Kevin.
Now
closer to Kevin.
You watched the Tom Hanks episode.
Yeah.
I was not allowed to directly look him in the eye. Did you know that?
Tommy?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Strictly forbidden. Only
jerk.
Kevin was allowed to look him in the eye.
He played Walt Disney, but unlike Walt Disney, he does not like Jews.
Did not care
Speaking
for either
of
us.
If
you're familiar with the rules, I'm not going to go over
don't
them
Don't do them. No,
you don't
do
need
it.
To,
let the listeners figure
Lord
it out.
Because Lord knows our fans know how this game works.
Great.
Okay, 5 points correct, 3 points wrong. Here we go.
Okay.
Tweet number one, Tyra, Paris, Bieber. Oh, I forgot. $20 at stake.
As always, we're playing for Dancing Andrew Jackson.
Again, he only danced in our old location, which
we had
for like 3 years.
Blowing
yep.
on him?
Yep.
Right.
Tweet.
Oh, look at that.
Number.
He's dancing.
Huh? All right. Well done, Gabriel.
Thank you. Sir.
Tweet number one. Live your dream. Be creative.
Taryn. Bieber.
Starting off strong, that's correct.
Fuck. It was too obvious.
You'd think some of these are obvious, some of them are not.
Damn son of a bitch. You know, Hank's tried the Bieber every time and see where it got him.
No, I know. No, that's true Bieber.
Yeah. You all right?
Water bit did not play.
Did not play. Did not play.
That's the saddest callback I've ever seen.
It didn't land.
What you need to do is throw it at me, but you were worried you might hit Jamie, so it's not worth the risk.
Too many cables.
Not worth the risk.
Oh, we've got questions from your fans, by the way.
Tweet.
Oh,
okay.
Jamie was kind enough to send me a bunch. Right, Jamie? Thanks, doll.
Two. Love going to my chiropractor to get adjusted.
Kevin.
Taryn.
Paris.
That is correct.
Oh, yes! We have not had two positive correct answers in maybe a year.
At least.
Okay.
At least. Tweet number three. When people meet me and assume I'm a party girl, hashtag frustrating.
Taryn. Hilton.
Gotta be.
Tyra.
What? What?
I was going to say Bieber. It must have been a trick. You wouldn't have put it on there if it weren't a trick. But
all right, well,
I was going to say Bieber just for the laugh.
Yeah. Right. I also don't want to miss the obvious.
No,
you know what I mean? It's the fear of missing the obvious.
Sure,
that's
sure.
That's why I did what I did.
That's why Jamie is so good at putting these questions together.
Yeah.
Or these tweets.
We've gotten a thumbs up and a shrug from Jamie on this podcast.
Sorry. This is my time whenever I could actually like go in and like do the I don't have to yeah.
Gotcha.
Sorry.
No. Wow. So I apologize.
Go ahead and tune out. We're good.
Yeah. Tweet number four.
Mm-hmm.
Learning how to ollie on a snowboard.
Kevin Taryn. Paris.
Gosh, dang it.
Tied at positive two. That was incorrect.
Ooh, that's a Bieber?
The Biebs.
Bieber.
Oh, so you did have it correct. You were loaded. All right, it's tied up after four questions.
Tweet number five. Loving all the legend and newbie Grammy collabs.
Taryn, Tyra.
That is correct. Strong comeback.
Motherfuck, I swear to Christ, I'm going to rip out your
eyes. Out of how many?
That was 10? Five. We got three to go.
Three, eight, okay.
Unless, of course,
so there's
a tie.
There's a strategy where I shut
Unless,
my mouth.
Unless, of course, there's a tie. Tweet number in bed, cuddling with my little love bugs, watching cartoons, hashtag loving life.
Kevin Paris.
Tied at seven, son of a bitch.
You're going down, sweet pants. Right. I'm about to break it to you.
May come down to this tiebreaker.
Okay.
Tweet number seven. Killing it at the Grammys.
Taryn. Bieber.
Has to be. Has to be.
Come on!
No, she's not!
This is bullshit!
No, she is not! I've seen them all and she wasn't!
Gentlemen, this is a very close game.
We've not had it this close in a while, Kenny!
Because here's what we got. Here's what we got. It's tweet number eight coming up, and it's only a 3-point differential.
Right.
Which means if I just lay back and do nothing, I can't lose.
Incorrect.
That's incorrect.
If he rings in and gets it correct, you will lose by 2 points. Yeah. If you ring in and get it wrong, it will be a tie.
Okay.
Math not my strength.
The eighth and potentially final tweet. Good to be on the first break in a while. Spending some quality time with my family.
Kevin Paris.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are tied.
It's Tyra.
Biebs!
Oh, wow!
The motherfucking Biebs. Well, this is it.
Okay.
I love it when we make it to a tiebreaker tweet.
It doesn't happen.
I love it, and I don't even need to. I already know it.
I feel better about your chances.
I know the tweet.
I'll be honest with you. Okay.
The tie-breaking tweet. Up in the air.
Taryn Bieber.
Correct.
That is your winner, ladies and gentlemen. Taryn, kill him.
Wow!
That is 194 shows. Someone gets it! Someone gets it!
Finally!
There it is!
Yeah!
Here, you can chuck
I'm
that.
I'm the best!
Get rid of
that. You ever come against me, say I ain't the best! Put a sucker like Crabtree against me! Crabtree! I'm the best! And who tweets?
Oh! Can you ask for more?
Don't you ever talk about him.
No.
Don't you ever talk about me.
Ask who is talking about me. Wow, thank you. Do I really take this?
Yes, you really do. Okay. Sammy!
That's how you play Who Tweeted.
Fun. Thank you.
Celebrity.
Celebrities have so much to say.
Who tweeted?
Is the game that we just played.
Please don't throw that mug. We don't have very many left.
I know. I can tell. I can tell that was valuable.
Yeah, you get the travel version, the travel mug version of the show cup. Boy, did these break
quickly. How about the water ring that's going to be on this table now that I threw my coaster?
It was Tom Hanks, the first one of 193 guests, who pointed out, why do you have coasters
for this horrible... That was Larry.
Oh, it was Larry?
It was Larry.
Yeah.
And I said, it's for the sound.
Hi, Sam.
Okay, I hit the very lip of the table, which, for the record, I could not do again if I tried.
The smallest surface space.
I could not do that again if
I'll give you $45
if
in three chances... You can do it again.
Here we go.
You give me $2 if you can.
Very well.
Okay?
So close. Oh, slid right off.
One.
That's one.
And three. $2.
Wow.
Okay.
Overshot it every time.
Now then.
Yes, sir.
Boy, that was fun for our listeners. not the viewers.
There's no way you're editing that out.
That's on the Christmas reel.
Fantastic.
This episode needs to be viewed. It needs to be watched because you have to, like,
too many visuals.
Yeah, there's too many visuals.
There you go.
Thank you, Sammy.
Yep.
Never let it be said.
By the way,
I don't welch.
Yes, $2 in singles available.
Like that?
I rarely have cash on me.
Poker player. This first one of many, Jamie, comes to you yelling. She loves it. Looks like from the Twitterverse at Christopher_H. This is a tweet five.
T5 forever now.
Speaking of comedic gods who were let go from SNL prematurely, Dave Koechner, perfect example. Mm-hmm. You know how the tweet fives work? The this or that, Coke or Pepsi, no correct answer?
Oh, okay, great.
Wild and out or short circuits?
Wild
and out, excuse
wild
me.
Wild now.
That was the Cannon, Nick Cannon.
They were both Nick Cannon's projects.
Uh-huh.
Short Circuits was a sketch show, while now it was comedy sports, competitive Who's Line in the urban hip-hop community.
Wasn't Short Circuits the third, the second sequel to Short Circuit?
Yeah, Short Circuits.
Short Circuit, Short Circuit 2, Short Circuits.
Yeah, exactly.
And it was all the other Johnny Fives that had come to life?
Oh, I wish.
Johnny's 1, 2, 3, and 4.
Mr. Levine, I wish.
Nobody's Watching or any other title?
Nobody's Watching.
Community or Scrubs?
Community.
SNL or Mad TV?
SNL.
Yes, Dear or According to Jim?
Yes, Dear.
Correct. You got 4 out of 5 correct.
Wait, that reminds me of
so
a story.
Close.
You remember when we ran into
Jim Belushi
and he was using an According to Jim keychain, and it just really made me laugh.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
It just really made me laugh.
We couldn't believe it.
It tickled me.
We thought it was kind of historical.
Yeah.
Look at that. He held on to the According to Jim keychain.
Hey.
This one comes to us.
These are my keys.
See? At Tammy Turner TTS from the Twitterverse, what's the scariest thing that has ever happened during your run on SNL? A fantastic question.
Wow.
The scariest thing.
The scariest thing. I guess the closest to scariest in how I translate it is when Mr. Justin Bieber was hosting, they're about to start a sketch, a dress, and a wall started falling on his head.
Saw this happening.
Yeah, and it was like coming down and almost hit him, and they caught it at the last second.
You did nothing to save him.
It's not my job. I'm not going to cross
But you could have
lines.
Used
the unions.
The union rules,
like,
very strict about that.
You could have used your superhero strength from your eyes.
It is a small space, but I was as far away from where he was within the small space.
But you saw it happening in slow
motion. Yeah, everybody did, like, there's a gasp, and the sketch has started. It's one of the best. I think it's online.
It is online with commentary.
Yeah, it's so
from
great.
From Hader and the writer, I think.
And
right?
Rob Klein and John Solomon. Yeah, John Solomon wrote MacGruber, which is, I think, the funniest movie of the last 10 years. And Rob Klein is the new head writer.
Check that out after the show ends.
Yep. Absolutely.
So that was the scariest moment by far, I would think.
Yeah, that was like someone's at physical risk.
Right.
Yeah.
Non-death threatening, scariest
scary.
Moment.
Scary. Non-death threatening, scary.
Like, is there a live moment in front of the, not dress, but live, you're on TV, we're as fans believing that every week something horrible is about to happen, but is it? and does it?
I've been in two sketches, and yes, I think there's someone who would be terrified by this, and I love it because it's specific only to this job. Last sketch of the night, the 10 to 1, where
they save 30, all the best
we're
for.
30 seconds over. We're 30 seconds over, we may have to cut something at the end, or we may just cut out of it. And I've been in two sketches where you're performing the sketch, and over the shoulder of the actor you're acting with, the writer's there scribbling, like saying, don't say this, writing in a new card, putting, like, say that, this new line, or we're cutting out here, so that's the end. And I've also been in a sketch where it just, like, just ended. Like, that's the end. Oh, okay, this is a great one. This is a great one.
Jesus.
Not scary, but hilarious, but like, no! Bruce Willis this year. There's a Centauri vodka sketch where he's like a centaur mascot for this new brand of vodka. That sketch on air ended 2.5 pages early.
Because
Bruce thought it was sort of like a similar cue. He's like, oh, when that's said, I leave and I walk upstage. And there's literally 1.5 pages left of story and
sketch.
Comedy to come
and
that just
button.
Never was. And a button. And, yeah. And it just he just went, this is done. And another sketch was able to be put back in because of that, which is hilarious. But I had the next line was supposed to be a cutaway to me as Bruce Jenner. And you can hear Nassim say the setup over the Chiron at the end. Like, they have the outside establishment show. He's like, you're freaking out Bruce Jenner. And that's the end of the sketch. I'm like, that's a weird last line to say over a building as I'm standing there making a Bruce Jenner face. And, like, he starts walking and we're all... Don't what? Okay, on to the next one.
He's pretty awesome.
Yeah, a great question.
Yeah,
thank you.
I'm sorry, but he's honestly answered most of these questions already during the show.
That's yeah, well, that's what happened.
And
that's what
even happened. There was one about Bruce Willis, and then you just answered it right now.
Like
it's, yeah, so
oh,
you're good.
It is my fault for going to the fan questions an hour 40 minutes into the interview. I've got to stop doing that.
Honest to God, you've gone through all of these questions, so everyone should be happy.
Awesome. I want to ask.
I won that game.
Well,
oh, dude, you crushed that game. It was a close one
game.
Too.
I don't know if you can remember, but you kind of celebrated.
What?
When you won.
He came out. Oh my God, you saw that.
Yeah.
I'm so sorry.
I've never seen anything like.
Oh
it.
Man.
Yeah, it was almost in my face. Just shy of I'm a horrible person.
Oh man.
For even sitting down and attempting to beat you at something. So you say you played organized sports in high school?
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. I see.
Is there any competition
on the
out?
Side of a mountain?
Yeah,
apparently.
Man. Yeah, right in the valley. A hill over from Holcomb Valley, bro.
How much are you actually able to do on the comic book on a weekly basis? So they're sending you drafts of everything. But how much writing are you able to do?
I do the entire first draft myself. And then I send that to Mark, and Mark helps me nudge it this way or that.
Forgive my ignorance.
And correct it.
How many pages is that?
22.
That first draft.
22. Yeah. So it's like page one, panel one, a helicopter flying over the ocean. Page two,
right.
Someone from the forest below looks up over their shoulder. They say,
right.
Here they come.
Right.
And so on and so on.
So you know your family's coming to live with you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly. I will have to put in less FaceTime. You know, I'm losing plane time, which is where I get so much work done.
Completely and utterly.
On the plane. Yeah.
There's no greater place.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of times I'll have a weekend gig and we'll fly here Sunday morning.
Yeah.
And I can guarantee that I'm going to get work done on that flight home for the dossier so that I don't worry about it as much on Saturday until I crash, pass out.
Yeah.
I mean, not
that
crash because I'm on a plane, but
I
pass
know.
Out.
It got dark.
Because I'm
like,
so tired.
I was never here. He disappeared. It was the ghost of Kevin Pollak.
While
I can't
we
believe
were
it.
Talking, he vanished.
I also love the echo of the laugh of the control room in the hallway.
You don't get that when you listen
pretty
to the show?
No, you can't hear it, but it's pretty great.
Tell me about the Jedediah, because, you know, in the dossier, J-Mac was kind enough to offer up an interview you had given where you talked about, I guess the question that they asked was much more succinct and kind of perfect about the moment where you sort of arrive on the show, and you had said, when you get something on update and someone says, hey, that's probably going to come back. What Hader found with Stefan.
Sure.
Is not rare. It's become a part of the show. I remember Dana talking about it 100 years ago. If you can get, when Hans and Franz appeared on Update.
Yeah.
I don't know that it was the launch of Hans and Franz. Probably right. Wasn't. But when they were on Update, mm-hmm. it became this other thing.
Yeah.
Because then you're stepping out of a sketch, and you're talking as the character.
Sure.
To camera and the audience.
It's when I get the most nervous, still.
I would think, because it's almost a form of stand-up.
Yeah, which I don't do or have never done. Attempted once and was terrible at.
It's not for me.
It's not. It's amazing.
Yeah, it's a lot harder.
You're on a tightrope. It takes a warrior spirit.
You live and die by your own wits. There's no writers.
Yeah.
There's no castmates. There's no cue cards.
It's terrifying.
If I may.
You may, please. I agree.
Jebediah.
Yes.
Kind of hits from the first laugh line.
Oh, yeah. That was.
I mean, it was out of the box.
That was a gift. It's a great look.
Yes.
It's a fantastic look.
Starts with
the
physical.
Which is huge. That's huge. It's a crazy story, the original story, that there was one guy who gave a negative review of the Gettysburg Address, which is just absurd.
Yeah.
The speech to end all speeches, at least in American history.
And that was one of those...
Which
is not the case with SNL. People forget
precise.
That it's never improvised. And
almost
they
never.
Really rather you not.
Exactly. They prefer you don't. And I love to.
Sure.
I love to and miss it. I miss that part of performing. So anytime there's a character that's a little loose, and I'm not saying that I improvise a bunch of jokes, but there's moments that are more play and banter between Seth and I that I really like. And that's the biggest indicator is that Seth was having a blast.
Yeah, and he's not afraid to have a blast.
Yeah,
role.
He's great at that. But you know the sincere laugh and the I'm setting you up laugh, and there was a lot of sincerity to the laughter, and that's so fun. And it and dress goes great, and then at air they have to trim it down, so I lose a couple of my favorite lines, which I'm like, that's fine. And it still goes very well, but it comes to a run that's like February 9th will forever go down in infamy, because that's the day you gave that boring-ass speech. And then that feeds right into another joke. Sometimes you grab the word that's on the next line on the cards by accident. So I said, that's the day you gave that speech that was boring ass, trying to save it. And this is a thing that's been going great. The audience has been fully on board, and just crickets. Like, everybody in that room went, that's not supposed to sound like that. There was a rhythm, there was music happening, and you just played the wrong note. And I got tickled by how desperate I was to fix it, that I somehow thought saying boring ass louder would make it a joke. So I was like, because it's supposed to be that you gave that boring ass speech. I could have used a couple kamikaze after that, and what it was that's the you gave that speech that was boring ass. And so now I'm like, my face is red and veins are popping to absolute silence, and I am dressed as an idiot from another century, and lost it a little bit. Because I don't like to lose it. I think our job is to make others lose it.
When you say lose it, you mean break.
Break, yeah, exactly.
Laugh at your own.
So the only times that I do is when something goes askew that was not planned for.
Sure. You know, if you break enough, one day you can host The Tonight Show.
That's right.
Hey, he said it. As a representative of NBC Universal and the Glory Company, I acknowledge the joke you made, and we'll continue on with this interview with no significant opinion on the subject.
And so we'll see more of that.
I would think so. I think we'll try it, yeah, but...
I'm going to ask a question that Jamie brought up. Were you going to ask a question about...
I was going to ask this question, too, because we were talking about Vinnie Vidalci.
Yeah.
What makes characters just go away that I feel that are working? Like, I love Vinnie Vidalci, and then he just, like...
And also the a-holes?
Yeah, two a-holes. Like, they just went away, and you never saw them again.
Like, they're on two or three times, and we think we love them, and they killed, and then for whatever reason... they're never seen again.
Yeah.
It just happened? It's just part of it?
Or is it like an oversaturation of it? Because I feel like maybe you see it too much in like one season or something, and then they go, I don't know.
There's a bit of both. There's so many hurdles. You're writing material for a minimum of four audiences. You're writing material that'll play at the table on Wednesday.
Huge.
You're writing material that will play to the audience in the studio, you're writing material that'll play to the audience at home that you don't know how they feel about it till at the earliest 12 hours later. Or I guess immediately, because of Twitter now, that helps.
Can I guess what the fourth audience is?
Sure.
Lauren?
I was gonna say myself.
Sure.
Fuck that guy, man. Hey, fuck, I don't care what he's saying. Lauren, I'm so sorry. Lauren, I'm so sorry. I want to make new friends. And man, I don't give a fuck what Lauren thinks of me. I'm my own man.
Lauren, thank you for the opportunity. You changed my life. Lauren, you changed my life. Thank you so much.
Man, I'm a straight up cold ass killer, man. I do what I do.
Thank you, Lauren. If you have any ideas of characters I should or should not be playing in the future, please let me know, Lauren.
So sometimes it's the writer who just goes, I don't want to do it again. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it's the show and the table that goes, we've seen this, we're not going to help you along with it. And sometimes it's the audience who goes, if it doesn't play as strong, what's the point of doing it again if you can't, if you can't elevate or if you can't do it better than the last time? That's kind of the rule of thumb.
You always have to hide.
Yeah, exactly.
So we will probably love something, whether it's killing for those other reasons, because we're not there.
Sure.
In the writer's room, we're not there in front of the audience even.
I've seen a-holes be cut at dress. I've seen a Stefan cut, which was odd, but that was very early on and then came back the next week. I think that was more logistical stuff. But I've seen significant recurring sketches be pulled. We've now done at dress 3 J-pops since the last one that have not made the show.
Wow.
Yeah.
Just a part of the show?
Yeah. And I, my opinion is just that that's another audience is the host, what the host likes participating in, you know what I mean? Because your sketch can live or die between dress and air. Based on a host going, no, I love that, let me do that, or I don't feel like doing that.
Right.
And I think that's maybe occurred a couple times.
Sammy, your last opportunity to ask one of your questions. We like to, every now and then, offer Sam a special opportunity, one that's earmarked for the guest that we know ahead of time that he cares more about than other guests.
I was really ill-prepared for this, but...
oh, my God.
If... I don't know if any of your hosts need like stand-ins.
Uh-huh.
But I'm looking to expand.
No, we do it. Guys, thank you so much. This has been so much fun, really. Huge fan of yours, Kevin. Jamie, you're so lovely. Sam.
Oh. All right, I guess that's not.
We don't have, the only times we have stand-ins are the stage managers.
So are you looking for a new stage manager?
You want to stage manage? Think about it. Dude, you're running with Broken Lizard.
I just want to get my
ride the Broken Lizard wave. You're doing great.
You know, podcasting doesn't pay what it used to.
What did it used to pay?
It used to pay nothing.
And now there's some money. Oh, good for you. Oh, that's great. Oh, that's awesome.
Now there's the promise of money.
Yeah.
Before there was no chance.
Yeah.
Now there's...
You'll get more cups.
2 more years. I don't want to pretend that I care anymore.
Great, thank you.
will you ever get used to the New York apartment? I guess you won't know till your family gets there.
That'll make it different.
Yeah.
Even walking around my apartment that we own, I'm realizing now like my kitchen has been like, oh, I guess I can put food there. And now it's very quickly becoming, oh, we need to, this is our family home now, and we need to stock that up. So that will definitely change my relationship. I'm excited to explore the surrounding areas, which I've never done.
Right.
I'm excited to take my daughter to Sleepy Hollow around Halloween, which will be so fun. You know, stuff like that, sort of true East Coast experiences.
Yeah.
Hamptons, I've never done that. So a little bit of that, but I think in my core I'm a West Coast guy. I just feel that I am.
Well, I think the born and raised...
Yeah.
Defines that. Because I'm born and raised wildly older, so I have more years invested in the raised part.
Great complexion, though, man.
Sure. Small pores.
Keeping up with that.
Tiny pores.
Elasticity.
That's
damn.
The key, yeah. And feeding off the younger. like a vampire.
Kalima. Kalima.
I'm dumb. I got it.
We got to plan 82 for that one.
We got to plan the Club 33. That's got to happen.
Oh man,
that's already in the works.
You've got to come. Angel. You've got to come back to LA during the summer months,
please.
Now, even though you guys will have the home there, you'll still come back, we think?
I would think at least once every other month or something.
Come on.
Yeah.
Because we've got to set up the Club 33. That has to happen. I can't thank you enough.
I'm not saying that, you already have.
Okay. Because I had nothing more.
Yeah, yeah. Great.
So thank you for that.
Thank you.
Sit there wildly uncomfortable, uncomfortably okay. while I wrap things up for the folks at home. But
great.
Honestly and truly, I meant it when I said it on the street, and I mean it even more now. I truly am a fan.
Thank you.
You're extremely
on the street, he said I was a genius, and now you're saying a fan.
Well, you know what? I'm going to give you one opportunity to get back to genius.
Okay.
Because...
okay.
If you did, by any bizarre chance, hang in for the full Tom Hanks, which you couldn't possibly have, 2 hours and 42 minutes.
I did.
We do a little thing called the Larry King game on the show.
Sure, sure.
You're okay. familiar with it?
I am.
Okay.
Yeah.
There's your camera.
Okay.
I want a bad Larry King impression.
Okay.
If you have a good one, I'm not interested.
Okay.
And then share something about Larry nobody wants to know.
Okay.
And then go to the phones. If the name of the city is funny.
Great, great, great.
Sounding.
Right.
You've hit all three marks.
Okay, great.
When you're ready, sir.
This is Larry King live here reporting from CNN. We're gonna cut to a commercial break. When we come back, I show you my large jar of fingernail clippings, and we'll have a deep, in-depth conversation with John from Zizek's, Nevada.
Every time we drive by, Zizek's.
Zizek's Road.
I don't think anyone has used Zizek's yet.
No, oh
it's
no,
a
no.
Great pull.
Thank yeah. you very much.
Deep,
yeah.
thank
deep.
You for that.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
That's kind of a very LA. Thing.
Yeah, well, that yeah, only exactly. happens on the drive to
only
Vegas
drive.
From
yeah,
Los
yeah.
Angeles.
From LA.
There's no other way to be aware of physics. Okay, good. We have an end roll from a sponsor. Imagine that. Who should we do this one as? Who did Taryn?
What about nobody?
Sorry?
Ashton Kutcher. I loved his
you
Ashton.
Do it as Ashton Kutcher.
Oh, no, you.
No, I
oh,
love
me.
His, okay. his okay. Ashton. It's amazing.
All right.
Now that the show's over, make sure to head over to squarespace.com. to start your free trial with no credit card required.
Make sure the offer code POLLOCK is used to get 10% off and to let Squarespace know we sent you. I thank you. Wow. Thank you for that.
Thank you.
I think we have to come up with another 20 for that last.
Yeah, at least.
Okay.
At least.
Next week, if you care to join us, it's the Michael Showalter. And then Anna Faris after him, and then... Curtis Armstrong. Sunday after that.
Oh, boy.
For your burger fan.
Or Charles DeMar.
Oh, no, please.
Better off dead.
Please, the list is endless. He's got an IMDb page that'll choke you.
Yes, it will.
One Crazy Summer guy, I'll say it.
Yes.
Yep.
Yeah.
One Crazy Summer.
Please, that's
the more of a Joel Murray joint.
Yeah.
The moment where his dad meets him on the dock and says, I'm proud of you, boy.
Oh, what? No, don't blank on his name.
Oh,
SCTV, no, don't blank on his name.
You know him. You know what happened to him? He died.
Joe Flaherty.
I was going to let you get there.
Joe Flaherty.
Yeah, I knew letting you get there.
Yeah. Proud of you, boy. And he hugs him on the dock. One Crazy Summer.
Let me tell you why Joe Flaherty is the most amazing sketch comedian, because it was in his 50s, 60s when I worked with him.
Yeah.
And I would ask him about an old SCTV thing. Not only would he tell me a 10-minute story, then he would start doing it with me.
Awesome.
He would do Guy Caballero with me.
So cool.
All day and night.
I guess if there's anything to take away from this, Kenny, it's that, Taryn, you need to learn how to be that generous with your time. You know, we've appreciated your commitment.
Yeah.
You're getting up in the characters and the voices and
yeah.
whatnot. But unless you're willing to do the sketches.
Okay.
With
yeah.
fans,
yeah.
You're
yeah.
just phoning it in.
All right. Fair enough.
Thank you.
I like to work with people who are better than me. You know, it elevates my game.
Is that a touche? I think that's a touche.
It's at Sam, and that's so undeserving.
No,
that
no.
you become this whipping boy, but
no.
it's a little bit of a role.
A little bit? It's because I'm away from the table.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I'm not allowed at the table.
Unlike when David Krumholtz was here.
Right.
That's another story.
Well.
Josh and J-Mac and Samantha and Daniel Overland, our media maven.
Or Danielle.
I say Daniel.
You yeah, did. I was like, do we have a David?
She has
David.
A little penis.
She has a nub.
Are we sure?
It's what I read.
I may have gotten that one wrong then, because I thought for sure that was a total lady.
Cockless?
Cockless lady.
Is what you're saying.
No peen.
Complete full-on
no
female.
Complete full-on woman from birth.
Okay.
Right. Maybe I'm wrong, right. But I'm pretty sure I'm not.
I'm not above admitting that
okay.
I'm wrong.
Okay.
I was wrong about that, and I apologize. Danielle, you do not have a penis. That I can prove.
Sure.
Okay. I think that wraps it up for this week, and what a tremendous opportunity this was for us to spend some time with someone that we're all such a fan of. So thanks again, Taryn.
Thank you.
And until next time, and as always, get out of my face.